We're in Charleston, Illinois, on the campus of Eastern Illinois. And tonight, the Panthers have a chance to wrap up a championship. But standing in their way, Tennessee State. It's ESPNU Primetime Football, and it comes your way next. Welcome to ESPNU College Football. We are coming to you live from a chilly O'Brien Field as tonight the Tennessee State Tigers take on the 13th-ranked Eastern Illinois Panthers in this OVC matchup. Checking the OVC standings, you see right away the importance of tonight's game for Eastern Illinois as the outright OVC title is on the line. Dan McLaughlin alongside former NFL quarterback Jay Walker, and of course, Jay, when you look at this game tonight, you win, you get a championship, so folks around this part of Illinois are pretty excited.
They are, and the team's excited. Coach Bob Spoo has his team in a great position. When you lift weights during the offseason, when you train and watch all that film, you do that so you can put your team in a position to win a championship and advance to the postseason. Their destiny is in their own hands.
As I mentioned, you're a former quarterback, so Jake Christensen has led the way. You have to have good quarterback play at any level, and this kid has really put up big numbers.
Yeah, he's been proof positive that one man can make a difference on this level of football. Christensen has come in with this gritty, tough style of play, 62% passer on the season, 18 touchdowns, 7 interceptions. He's been the difference maker for Eastern Illinois this season.
You see over 2,000 passing yards, third in the conference, 18 touchdowns. That's second, and he's the reigning player of the week in the conference. Now on the flip side, Tennessee State, boy, this has been a struggle. They have dropped four straight. What's happened?
Yeah, what could go wrong went wrong. They got beat up. They've got injuries. They've got true freshmen playing that have to mature ahead of schedule, and they haven't been able to rise to the challenge. Coach Webster's on the hot seat down there. You could say rightfully so. After losing four straight football games, they have high expectations in Nashville. The Tigers have not met it. Those expectations this season, but one thing they do have is defense, and anytime you have defense, you've got an opportunity to win football games.
Tennessee State won the toss, and they have elected to receive. They've got Clifford, Levine, Robertson, Hills. Any one of those four players could return. Austin Signer will kick it away, a redshirt senior. Wears number 48 for the Panthers. And we're underway, and we hope you enjoy this battle inside the OVC. Fielded inside the 5, down at the 4, and a big tackle out at the 17-yard line. And a hard hit that time for the Panthers on special teams by Desmond Ward, who's a backup running back. So the Tennessee State Tigers will have it 1st and 10. And they have dropped 4 in a row. The Panthers, meanwhile, have won 4 in a row. And Eastern Illinois, we're talking to the coaching staff. Boy, they are pumped up about this game tonight.
They've got to be. You know, you're so close so far. We'll go over the different FCS playoff scenarios as the night progresses. But you've got to be excited. If you take a look at Calvin McNarl there, the quarterback for Tennessee State, 52%. Anytime you've got a quarterback with a TD ratio of around 7 to 8, then they're not having a good season and your offense is struggling.
They've got 4 wide receivers. They put a man in motion. They'll hand it off to him. And making the tackle inside was Smith down at the 18 and a short pickup, maybe of just 1 yard on the play. On the carry that time, Chris Collins, the wide receiver out of Memphis, Tennessee. So 2nd down and 8 after the pickup of 2. You see at the top portion of your screen the starting lineups here on ESPNU. How much do you think that we'll see Tennessee try to keep this on the ground and make it a possession type game where they control the clock?
I think they would like to, but they've got a freshman running back that's starting tonight by the name of Travis Ward. And they're trying to get him going. He only averages 2.9 yards per carry.
And the play clock was down to 3, and they get the play off, and that's Travis Ward, the running back. He goes at 5'10", 210 pounds, only a freshman out of Dillard High School.
Now, this was a very highly recruited young man out of Florida. He's a fantastic football player. His best football is clearly ahead of him. They said if we can get him to understand the mental aspects of this game, right now he's acting like a true freshman. He's making a mistake on every other play, and that's what the offensive coordinator said. If we get him to shut to at least minimize the mental errors, he's going to be a fantastic football player.
But they said this kid is electric, and he'll touch the football an awful lot tonight. Now, in that last play, the play clock was down to about 2. This time, it's under 10. And after the first down was picked up, it's a flag on the play before they snapped it away.
Before the snap, false start, offense, number 63, 5-yard penalty, still first down.
It's Anthony Woods, a 6'4 freshman out of Detroit.
Now just look at the game plan for both schools. And for Tennessee State, the offense has to stay on the field. They can't get three and outs, and they've got to make a statement on defense. Their defense thinks they're the best defense in the conference. Prove it tonight. Eastern Illinois, control the skill positions. Tennessee State is very dangerous on the edge with the skill position.
First and 15, they want to throw the football and set up a screen the other way. They do. They'll pick up 6 on the play and across the original line of scrimmage on that catch. And it was almost a sack in the backfield, and that's the good speed there of Jonathan Moore, wide receiver out of Nashville, Tennessee.
And one of the things you see, the last point I had there was play for tonight. You know, for Eastern Illinois, they can sit there and they can wait. And if they don't win this football game, they can still clinch a championship. But handle your business tonight on the football field. Play for tonight. Don't look ahead. Don't look towards 2 weeks. Play tonight's football game.
Second down and 7. They'll hand it off in a big hole and a first down. And brought down near midfield. And a huge first down for Dante Thomas.
Dante Thomas is a guy that can get it done for them. And you'll see the handoff here on the zone replay on the inside. With Thomas, he averages 4 yards per carry. And they were concerned about how many carries he would actually be able to do in this football game. He's coming in, like most football players this time of the year, he's extremely banged up. But when he's healthy, you can see why the coaches think he's a good football player.
Starting cornerback C.J. James limping to the sideline for the Panthers of Eastern Illinois. So first and 10, they're in Panthers territory, and they'll hand it off to the freshman this time, who spins to pick up 3 yards on the play, and that's Travis Ward, his second carry tonight.
They seem to have some success right now running to the left side of the line of scrimmage, and that's kind of surprising there considering they've got a true freshman starting over there at that left tackle position. But go where it's working. Right now they're able to win that matchup on the line of scrimmage along that left side.
Second and 7 with the ball on the 38. We're just underway here on ESPNU from Charleston, Illinois, home of the Eastern Illinois Panthers. O'Brien Field. They'll put a man in motion. This will give them 3 wide receivers here if they elect to do so. Little play action, rolling to his right and throwing. And the catch made, and then dropped, and they'll say that's incomplete after the big hit right towards the middle of the field, and that was Gordy Kickles, a linebacker, the sophomore from Lamont, Illinois, with the big delivery there.
When you talk about teams that are struggling offensively, it's not having the ability to hit the open man in time. So the quarterback there, McNall, had the bootleg action, and because he hesitated with the read, got rid of that ball too late, the wide receiver Wilkins was in a vulnerable position, didn't have time to make the catch and pull it in. Had the quarterback gotten the ball to him quicker, would have been an easy first down pickup.
Haynes was also near the football, and it brings up 3rd down and 7. They'll work from the shotgun here. They blitz, and nowhere to go. They'll have to kick it away. And a loss of 10 on the play as McNarl was brought down.
Yeah, look at the bodies here. Look at number 94, Andre Lima, coming right up the middle. Nose tackle gets there, then they bring the whole kitchen sink. That's Corey Lehman coming in from the linebacker spot. Nick Nasty contributing as well. And that was just what you call a good old-fashioned jailbreak there. No place for the quarterback to go.
That's Rashad Haynes standing back on his 10-yard line for the Panthers of Eastern Illinois. They'll angle this to the left side. And
almost.
Yeah, that's a fumble. That was not a fair catch, and he did fumble it. And they will start at the 12 when we come back. It's college football tonight on ESPNU. Cold night here in Illinois. College football primetime on ESPNU. 10:55 to go in our first quarter of play. What's on tap in tonight's telecast? Tony Romo, the early years right here. Also, Professor J looking dapper. 1978 national champions. And, of course, our campus connection. It'll concern coaches here at EIU. And, boy, there have been some good ones, partner, that have come through the ranks here.
I think the viewers will be surprised at some of the names that have come through this school.
movement up front that will look to be against the Panthers, and I believe that was Roosevelt Holiday who jumped on the right side.
Offense, number 63, 5-yard penalty, still first down.
Check that, it's Otis Hudson. So you could have gone with either one, so Hudson whistled for that. He's only 6'5", 331 pounds. You don't miss him when he jumps.
You know, it's so funny when the big guys move, how they try and make themselves seem small. When you're that big, everybody sees you. Just stand up and man up to it. I did it.
So Jay Christensen out of Lockport, Illinois, and a transfer from Iowa. Hands it off, and not much of a gain, if any. What has made Christensen so good this year?
The ability to come in there with the confidence. You know, when you've got a quarterback that transfers from a Big Ten school, a lot of the players say, hey, let's take a look at him, and he's got that swagger about him. And you talk about in Christensen, a guy that was competing head-to-head with Ricky Stanzi. So it's not as if he left Iowa because he couldn't play. He just got beat out in an unfortunate situation, and the coaches at Iowa hated to see him go, especially considering what happened to their season when Stanzi went down. But Jake Christian wanted to play some more football, and fortunately for Eastern Illinois, he's had a place to go.
And he'll work out of the shotgun. Three wide receivers to his right side. Now they'll put a man in motion. And he'll throw the football here. To the sideline it goes. The catch made and wrestled out of bounds short of that first down marker. And the tackle was by Calvin Baker, the linebacker from Columbus, Georgia.
And look at the quick decision. One, two, three, looked off the defense, got rid of it. Simple out pattern, but you'd be surprised how many college quarterbacks struggle to hit a simple out pattern.
Why is that?
Well, it's a throw they made time and time again, but they overthink, and then they lose their accuracy, and you get a rush coming in your face, and all of a sudden you start to panic and look at the rush instead of looking at your wide receiver downfield.
Bob Spoo, 23rd season at Eastern Illinois, and ever. 140 and 111.
He's been here forever.
I was downstairs, and he had recruits going through and talking to prospects that could be here. Blitz coming. They pick it up. Christensen to the sideline, lofts it, and the intended receiver about a step short. That's Chris Wright, the freshman from Skokie, Illinois, and they'll have to punt it away.
I saw those same kids you saw. That amazes me. I mean, the kids coming out of high school, they look like college, like they're almost NFL ready now. I mean, kids are getting bigger and faster and stronger.
So deep in their own end, Kevin Cook will have to punt it away.
Well, this is something, if you're Eastern Illinois, this is not what you want. Tennessee State did a good job of moving the ball, getting it at least to midfield before they had to punt the ball away. Then they pinned Eastern Illinois with their back against the wall, and Eastern Illinois did not pick up a first down, so it's a good start thus far for the Tigers of Tennessee State.
But it was shanked that time, and it takes a bounce that favors the Tigers. They'll have in a good field position when we come back. It's Senior Day. Tennessee State, Eastern Illinois tonight on ESPNU. A punt of 31 yards.
Let's go pee.
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 Having some fun tonight here at Eastern Illinois, the 13th ranked club in the country. And it all started back in 1899. First team in school history, and for some seniors, comes to a close, the home portion tonight. But they've got postseason play to think about, partner.
Yeah, that's why I don't understand the tears. Don't cry. I mean, you got a lot more football ahead of you. Teams see that, your opening round opponent in the postseason, they say, wait a minute, these guys aren't as tough as we think they are.
McNarl will keep it himself on an option play, and he'll pick up maybe five.
Calvin McNarl.
He's out of Paris, Tennessee, and Henry County High School.
So often when you're the quarterback, you know, you get so much of the too much credit, and you also get too much blame. And it's easy to take a look and say, hey, the team's not doing well offensively. They're only averaging 14 points a game. They've got some issues at quarterback. But the coaches really stood up for him and said, hey, this is a good kid. He's doing what we ask him to do. You know, but what do you do when you just don't have enough weapons around you and people are getting injured left and right throughout the football season?
Travis Ward in the backfield. And they'll do play action to him, swing it to the left side. And no gain on that play. They may have lost yardage on it as well. And that was Dominique Grooms. Any on that.
That's something as a quarterback, fundamentally. You don't take a hitch or a double clutch of a pass when it's one of those little bubble screen, wide receiver bubble screens. You get the ball to him as quickly as possible. I don't know what McNarl saw there on that play. The wide receiver was waiting for the football, and it's two times early in this contest that he's double clutched and held onto the football, resulting in bad plays for the Tigers.
Third down and seven. McNarl, a little shovel pass here. And that's a play that gets misunderstood by the fans. It looks like that would be a fumble, but it actually is not a play that's dangerous because of what you just saw right there. It's an incomplete pass.
Yeah, it is. And when you complete it, you really like it because you're getting those free yards that you normally would give away to a running back. But this is a design pass, shovel pass there. You got to make that catch there. And that's just a bad call to have when you've got a blitzing defense. In that case there, anytime we see Tennessee State get third and long situation, it seems as if Eastern Illinois is going to bring pressure. And they brought outside goes as well as the linebackers up the middle. And that's a great play call against that type of offensive call.
Just James Webster there. Been under fire fifth season at Tennessee State. And the kick is deep. They'll let it bounce, and it rolls into the end zone. So they'll have it first and 10 at the 20. Busy night of sports. College ranks here on ESPNU. Coverage of men's college basketball and the Charleston Classic continues later tonight. LaSalle takes on South Carolina, the Gamecocks. The Charleston Classic on ESPNU tonight at 9:30 Eastern. And as always, for more information, log on to ESPNU.com.
Did I hear you say that James Webster has a little bit of heat on him down there in Nashville, Tennessee?
A lot of heat, yeah.
I think they're burning up down there.
Yep. And that's the thing you hear from the media, the fans. Christensen steps up, and the lefty has it deflected up front.
Good pressure up front. You've got coaches that are on the hot seat. You know, they're talking about whether or not his job is on the line. So often you lose a football team. But one thing you're seeing here from Tennessee State, they're not losing a football team. They've got bodies getting pressure. Dante Nichols, the big nose tackle, getting up there and getting his hands on it. And that's what you want to see. You know, for them, the defense has been, they're hanging their hat on their defense, and they're continuing to do that here tonight. It doesn't look like there's any quitting these boys, regardless of what the coaching situation may or not become at Tennessee State.
Mentioned that the Gamecocks are coming up in basketball later tonight. Well, that big man who wears number 79, the former South Carolina star, as the handoff will go to Williams.
Take a look at the impact players for tonight. Who has to show up big? Well, for Tennessee State, their defense is their offense. They need Rodney Fritz to make some tackles on the edge, get around there, get some sacks, disrupt the backfield. John Jones is what they just call a freak of nature. He's a guy that just makes football plays. He can get around the football, make things happen. One of those unscripted kind of linebackers where you don't necessarily want to confine him into a box. You want to let him freelance, and he finds a way to come up with big plays for the Tigers.
He's a transfer from the University of Florida, just over 7 minutes now, under 7 minutes to go. In our first quarter play, Christensen, plenty of time, fires over the middle, and there's your first down across midfield at the 49 as the catch was made by Lawrence Ricks.
Look at the great job by the offensive line. Look at this zone. I mean, there's a big wall right there. He could have run for the first down if he wanted to, but why run when you can throw it through a strike right on the number three of Lawrence Ricks there in the middle of the coverage? Look at that. That's a very accurate ball there. Wasn't it? Hit him right in stride. Easy to play wide receiver when you got a quarterback throwing darts.
And it's easy for a quarterback to find your receiver when you have that kind of protection. Great job up front. So they pick up the first down. First time in Tennessee State territory. They'll keep it on the ground, and depending on the spot, it'll be a very short pickup.
John Williams, the ball carrier.
Williams again, the ball carrier.
Part of the reason that Eastern Illinois has had success this football season, when you talk to the coach, hey, we're not flashy, you know, our star player is going to be our quarterback, but they've got an offensive line that is experienced. Chris Campbell's a senior. Chris Vaccaro, the left guard, is a senior. Chaz Millar, who he says is probably the best football player on this team that has NFL scouts asking about him, he's a senior. Then you go to the right tackle, Otis Hudson, another senior. When you've got that much experience on the offensive line, teams can't dictate what you do offensively. You dictate to them what you're going to do offensively.
Showing blitz from the outside. They'll pick it up. Christensen trying to get out of trouble. He won't.
Fumble.
Ball is loose. It's fumbled and picked up by the Tigers. And there's Jones, who we highlighted as far as our impact player. And, Jay, he makes a big play here.
Yeah, just being around the football. You know, they're bringing the pressure. And initially, the offensive line did a good job of picking up this stunt with a blitz. But that double clutch right there got to him. And you see Jones was a guy that missed him going by the first time, but not the second time. Picked up the fumble recovery. And, you know, there's something going on here. You know, you can tell with the elements. It's a little bit dreary. It was misty all day. And I see more upsets occur in college football when weather becomes a factor. When the guys just don't get hyped up because the sun's not shining and you get a little rain out there and it slows down your thought process. And all of a sudden, the team that you're supposed to blow out the water, you let them hang around and you find yourself in a football game.
And the other thing, too, it's senior night here. Emotions running high there.
Crying before the game. I told you, I didn't like that, son.
And you realize what's on the line. Chance to win the championship. You get a little ahead of yourself. Tennessee State will just throw it out of bounds. Incomplete with 5:37 to play. Tennessee State has had great field position for the most part in this first quarter.
Nothing to show for.
Right.
So then you wonder why a team has lost four straight games when the defense has been playing fantastic. And when you get the ball in this type of field position, you've got to put some points on the board. Put the pressure on the other team. See if they can score on your really good defense. Don't have them playing from behind. Very disappointing for Tennessee State. If you'd have told them they'd have controlled the football as long as they have the first quarter with the field position they have, and the game still be 0-0.
Put the tight end in motion. Now use him as a blocker in the backfield. Here's the pressure up the middle. Scrambling. McNarl gets out of bounds, and they'll mark him at the 43-yard line.
Get rid of him. You got to get rid of this football. I mean, the moment when you're running for your life like this, the moment you get outside, okay, where can I throw it away? He ran, and it was just like a sack because he lost 3 yards. You know, as you mature in the quarterback process, get rid of the football. That's a freshman mistake. You wouldn't expect to see that from a sophomore.
Log on to Facebook today, search ESPNU, and become a fan. Post your best tailgating photos and comments, and we may use them on Inside the Polls, Monday at 6 on ESPNU HD. Third down and 12. They'll swing it to the left side. Incomplete pass, and they'll have to punt it away.
You know, what we like doing Facebook, we like to hear from everybody. One thing I think is unique about the OVC, they've got some very unique team nicknames. You know, we got Tigers and Panthers here. These are probably two of the more boring nicknames in the whole OVC conference. So let's go to Facebook and see what the folks have to say about what they think are some of the unique nicknames in the Ohio Valley Conference, and then I'll give you my favorites a little bit later on. Got any thoughts on that?
No, I like Panthers and Tigers. For play-by-play guy, this is easy.
Keep it simple.
Exactly. Another good kick and a fair catch called for and fielded at the 11. So they'll start inside their own 15 again. Tennessee State, Eastern Illinois, after a 32-yard punt, and there's no score.
Now it's time for this week's Professor J, coming to you from the campus of Eastern Illinois University in Charleston, Illinois. I'm standing in front of a building they call Old Main Castle, which was constructed in 1899. This building was not designed to be energy efficient, but don't let that fool you. The folks here in Eastern Illinois take green technology very serious. So much so that they were recently recognized by the Environmental Protection Agency as a top 10 university in green technology. Did you know that?
I had no idea. That's impressive.
I'm trying to teach you some things on and off the field.
So we have other segments with Professor Jay tonight.
We'll school you a little bit. Class is in session.
Okay. Now, when you do these, do you mostly focus on what's going on around the campus, or are you doing a little teaching of football too?
No, we do the football during the game. Teach you the X's and O's here, and I think, you know, we would be doing a disservice to the people and the viewers if we didn't give the people what they want. You come to Charleston, Illinois, they want to know something about.
Okay.
Talk about Tony Romo and the other stuff, but what about green technology and things like that they do? And Tennessee State gives you some things that you may not know about Tennessee State.
All right.
And the Ohio Valley Conference.
Put a man in motion. Here are the Panthers with Christensen. Good time, and fires it to the right side. And it brings up a long third down. Glad you're with us here on ESPNU. Tennessee State and Eastern Illinois. They are number 13 in the country. O'Brien Field in Charleston, Illinois. Jay Walker, Dan McLaughlin. Jay, of course, a former NFL quarterback. And what's at stake tonight? Pretty easy to figure this one out. Eastern Illinois, if they win, they win the OVC title outright. So a huge game for their program this evening.
It is, and they don't seem to be rising to the challenge right now. They've got some matchup problems. You know, the skill position that we talked about for the game plan, Tennessee State's got some skill positions, especially on defense, that's given Eastern Illinois fits right now.
Showing blitz and nowhere to go with it. So it'll bring up a fourth down and five, and Christensen and this offense is stalling right now. I will say this, Tennessee State, and you'll see the blitz coming in here. You know, Jay, if you look at some of their losses, one game by 3 points, another by four, the other one was by five. I mean, they could have won those games, as we talked to the coaching staff, very easily. And all of a sudden, if you do that, it's a completely different looking season.
And just add a little offense. I mean, what else can you say? You're averaging 14 points a game. You should come in dead last in any conference in America. But the fact their defense is playing so well and only giving up 19, which is why they were respectable at certain points of the season.
And that'll take a bounce that's fielded inside the 40 in a dangerous play that time.
What was he doing?
And the punt is 49 yards. 49 yards on the punt. ESPNU's coverage of college football continues Friday night. Akron Zips take on conference rival Bowling Green. College football primetime built by the Home Depot on ESPNU and ESPNU HD Friday at 5:30 Eastern. For more information, log on to ESPNU.com. So big game there in the MAC. College football primetime built by the Home Depot.
I saw Dan LeFever last night, Central Michigan going to the MAC championship. And you know, one thing you like about the MAC, last year everybody talked about Ball State 12-0 regular season. They didn't even win the MAC championship game.
Right. Ball State has fallen on hard times, though, this season. Lost last week to Northern Illinois in a game that was seen on ESPNU. Nice job defensively. And that's Seymour Lofton, the free safety that came up to trip up the running back. And this time, that was Dante Thomas.
You have to wonder, if Thomas wasn't bruised up, would he be able to get more from this here? Good bounce to the outside. No blue jerseys outside. Run to the color. You don't see anything. And you go down by that tackle there, it makes me think he's just not running 100% right now.
Four wide receivers, one man in the backfield, just over 2 minutes to play in our first quarter. They'll hand it off. Some nifty running here. That's Thomas across midfield. And once again, Tennessee State in good field position. And Tennessee State, you know, one thing they have done throughout their season is play defense. And like you mentioned, Jay, offense really a question mark.
Yeah, right now they've got a spark going in the running game. Anytime a team is going to come out and play cover two with only 7 men in the box, your offensive line has to be able to push them around and get some positive yardage. And right now, Dante Thomas is having a good job running the football.
These are his season numbers, approaching 300 yards.
Good block. Ooh, no
penetration. And nowhere to go that time. Thomas again on the carry, and the tackle by Trevor Frericks. He's 6'1", 270 pounds out of Quincy, Illinois.
Yeah, look at him, number 99. He just beat the center right from the jump. Bad job of blocking there by Sherman Carter, and Trevor Frericks just made him pay for it. And anytime you get a nose tackle that can get tackles for losses behind the line of scrimmage, defensive coordinators just go crazy. They love that. They wish they could get that on every running play, but that's how you start to control the line of scrimmage.
Thomas has had a good night with 4 carries for 40 yards for Tennessee State. The Tigers have it here, second down and 13. The show blitz. They don't pick him up. Little pump fake, and he finds an open man. And they'll pick up 4 on the play. But no one picked up. The free safety coming flying through. And yet he doesn't get the sack or even have a chance at the tackle.
Yeah, he came from such a deep angle. That's something where you want him to time this up. And they're actually going to do a little zone blitz here. So they're all going to stunt to the left. And he's going looking at the quarterback's eyes. See that? That was C.J. James looking at the quarterback's eyes. So he got thrown off. Normally, a good offense will make you pay. If you blitz a good offensive team and you don't get to the quarterback, then they're going to hit you for a big play. But because of the struggles of Tennessee State, you blitz them and they only hit you for a 4-yard gain.
Third down and 10, their fourth third down of the night. Low snap. They'll look to that far sideline in double coverage, and that's incomplete. With 21.1 seconds remaining in our first quarter.
It's not there. I mean, that's something. Right now, you've got Eastern Illinois playing a cover two. And anytime you're playing cover two, you've got to attack the middle of the field. And they're throwing to the sidelines, the seams. If you're going to take that throw, that's got to be more of a line drive throw, not one that you put air on underneath. So that lets me know that McNarl's not seeing the field right now. because they're not doing anything exotic on defense. They're coming out playing cover two, allowing their front four to get pressure on the quarterback, and Tennessee State has not made the adjustments.
Get up. Cisneros will kick it away. Rashad Haynes calling for the fair catch, and he makes it. They wanted to flag on that after he motioned for the fair catch. It's a 35-yard punt, 13 seconds remaining in our first quarter of play.
Once again, Eastern Illinois is getting the football, backed up, not great field position. But this is a time where you expect the senior leadership of a Jake Christensen to step up and put together a nice 13-play drive, or at least get to midfield so you can start to win the battle field position.
So number 13 in the land, Eastern Illinois. They've been held scoreless and really stopped offensively. They have not done much here. Christensen, 2 of 4 for 29 yards to start this game. The Panthers throwing on first down. Catch made. And a pickup of 3, maybe 4 on the play. That should be the final play of our first quarter. And it will be after the catch. When we come back, a campus connection. It's Tennessee State, Eastern Illinois, the Panthers and the Tigers on ESPNU. College football primetime on this Thursday night here on ESPNU, no score. The ESPNU Campus Connection is a program designed to get the pulse of the campus through student-generated content. Here is John Torque.
When I tell people that I go to Eastern Illinois University, they usually ask me, isn't that where Tony Romo went?
Before he was the starting quarterback for the Dallas Cowboys, Romo was a three-time All-American at EIU, and in 2002, Romo was the first player in OVC history to win the National Walter Payton Award. Last month, Romo became the first EIU football player to have his jersey retired.
So the number retired here at the stadium, number 17 he wore here, October 17th of 2009, Tony Romo.
Tell you something they may not know. He does not hold the single season record for passing yards in a season. Won the Payton Award, still had a quarterback before you that threw for more yardage.
And a handoff this time. And a nice gain. Second effort. Mon Williams out of Mesquite, Texas. And he's also a transfer from the University of Florida. Tony Romo, back in his playing days, late 90s, early 2000. And the 0-2 Walter Payton Award winner. And a two-time All-Pro in the National Football League. The quarterback of the Dallas Cowboys.
And winning that award, I mean, you know, you've got the Heisman Trophy on the FBS level, and the Payton Award is the equivalent of the Heisman on the FCS level. It takes more than just good football play to win that award. You've got to have a marketing campaign behind you, put up good numbers, have the rest of your peers vote for you there. So that is a very prestigious award that he was a recipient of.
So look at his career numbers, 8,000 plus yards, second in school history, closing in on 90 touchdown passes, and as we mentioned, the Walter Payton Award, top offensive player in FCS. Makes you wonder who was the best passer, stats-wise, here in school history. Jay Walker, Dan McLaughlin with you. Of course, Jay, a former National Football League quarterback.
Didn't win the Payton Award either when I was at Howard. Came in sixth, but hey, he was up for it.
That's right. Mentioned. Big hole right up the middle. And carry that time by Jimmy Potempa, who's a 5'7", 170-pound. He is quick running back. A lot of transfers. It's something that you see in this division of football, and he is from the University of Michigan.
And that's kind of what you have to do now, and there have been some steps made in place that will actually help out the universities a little bit more. No longer will you start to see guys come in and transfer for 1 year. With the rules changed by the NCAA, I mean, if you're going to transfer down, you've got to have at least two seasons of eligibility left. I think that's really going to help the quality of play on the FCS level.
On third and four to the sideline, and the clock will continue to run. They can't get out of bounds, and on third down, they are going to be short, it looks like, of that first down marker. Well, you've got to know where you're at as a wide receiver, where that first down marker is.
You do, and that's your job and responsibility. If you've got the out route, make sure you get your full depth on the out route.
Ryan Berry is deep for Tennessee.
Let's see if we get a late hit here, but no call.
Quick release there, getting rid of it, and oh, yeah.
As much as they call it now, it probably was.
At home, too. Normally, you know, you go on the road, you don't get that call, but your home place, you're supposed to get that call.
It's a high snap, but the kick is away. And look at this kick, a booming punt. And that'll go all the way into the end zone. And a late flag on the play. That's a 64-yard punt. That's his career long, that 64-yarder, and that was a late flag. The flag rests at the 40-yard line.
Personal foul, number 74 on the kicking team. 15-yard penalty will be added. It was a touchback. First down.
So the penalty against the kicking team. We've got no score here in Illinois. Professor Jay coming up when we come back.
How would a college degree improve your life? Consider this. For every dollar invested in a quality education, you'll receive $18 in return. This equates to over $1 million in additional lifetime earnings just for obtaining your college degree. As one of the nation's finest public universities, Murray State is committed to helping you make the right investment decisions for your future at a price you can afford. Because today, college is no longer an option, it's an economic necessity.
$5 for a sub, but no drink, no chips. Man, that's roughing the wallet. Now this is a total package.
A $5 match NFL box. Choose from six KFC favorites.
Every university likes to brag about the famous people that have walked through their hallways as students. And Tennessee State University is no different. Without offending Richard Dent, Ed Too Tall Jones, and the famous Tiger Bells, I think they've got one name that stands above them all. As a matter of fact, it's one word, Oprah. Enough said. Did you know that?
Well, as much as you appreciate the career of Tony Romo, I thought you were gonna say Romo, not Oprah.
Romo's big, but Oprah's a little bit bigger,
oh, yeah.
I would think so.
The checkbook is a little bit bigger too.
Did you know she went to Tennessee State University?
I had no idea.
A lot of folks didn't know that. You could say, arguably, they've got the most influential person in the entertainment business that strolled the halls of the campus there in Nashville.
So we have no score in this ball game here. 13 minutes remaining in our first half of play. And what has happened here? Why has Eastern Illinois really struggled offensively in this ball game?
Well, I think we found out the Tennessee State defense is as good as advertised. They came in here, one of the best defenses in the conference, and they're showing it. Credit to defensive coordinator Rod Reed. He's really sticking it to them. And offensively for Tennessee State, they're as bad as advertised. They can't move the football. They can't get points on the board, even though they've had success running the football tonight, as they're doing right now.
Jay, they've had four possessions and four punts. Carry that time by McNarl. So some famous alumni, and there you go for Tennessee State. Ed Too Tall Jones, number one overall pick back in 74.
Yes, and the Richard Dent Super Bowl MVP. Anthony Pleasant played many years in the National Football League, and more recently, DRC, as they like to call him, Dominique Rogers-Cromartie. First round pick, played in the Super Bowl last season.
Stay on the ground this time and spinning. And he's got a little extra jump than we thought coming into play tonight. That's Dante Thomas.
Now, I got to go back to that list there. That list is shortchanging some people. Now, they got some legends, you know. One of the best college football nicknames I've ever heard in my life. There was a quarterback at Tennessee State that played for the legendary coach they have, John Mayer, by the name of Eldridge Dickey. His nickname was the Lord's Prayer.
That's his nickname. Now, what's the story behind it?
He was so dominating that you didn't have a prayer against him.
Gotcha.
And he and the coach used to ride to the games in a Cadillac, and the rest of the team rode with a bus. That's a true story.
Second down and five now for Tennessee State. Play clock is down to two, down to one, and they just got it away. They'll be short of the first down marker on the carry. That was Travis Ward.
And you see, they're able to, you know, once you get positive yardage on first down, that really, to me, is the down that really dictates what's going to happen the rest of your drive. You pick up positive yards on first down, you can follow that up with second down yardage, and you get third and less than three, very makeable situation. The defense doesn't know what to expect.
Bunch of changes offensively, third and one. Now, is this where you would anticipate you go with the bigger back at this point, which is Dante Thomas? He's around 215 pounds.
I see the little guy in the backfield, though.
Yeah. And they're going to be short. Spinning on it was Ward, trying to bounce it to the outside, and he came up short of that first down marker. Here's a question for you. If your coaching staff is under fire and you see the push up front or the lack of a push, you're 3-6, 2-4 in conference play.
You go for it.
You go for it is the question.
You go for it. I mean, you can't get a yard in two plays, and offensively, you know, you're poor. I mean, that's a harsh way to put it, but you've got two plays to gain 1 yard. If they stop you, then you're just going against a better team. It's going to be a long night.
So a timeout taken by the Tigers. Fourth down decision. We come back on ESPNU.
Nearly 1.5 centuries ago, we built a spectacular future on a rock-solid foundation. As our landscape, our campus, and our students have changed, our mission has not. We are still Southeast.
On the season, 5 of 17 on fourth down. Coach Webster says, gentlemen, we're going for it. Play action, gutsy call, first down.
He was scared to throw it, too. He had the fullback wide open in the flat. But I don't blame him. I'm just nitpicking on you right now. But fullback wide open, you're supposed to give him that ball. You'll see number 37, who they brought in there, Ronald Bright. Right there, he's looking, but he's like, I'm not throwing it to you. Call his own number. That'll make you feel good. There you go right there. You see that? Hype up everybody. Let's go. I like that. I like that. No quitting James Webster.
First and 10 with the ball on the 40. They'll hand it off to the first man through, and a pickup of 5 on the play. Again, Dante Thomas, and there's a look at the fifth-year head coach, James Webster, and his numbers overall.
I mean, and you take a look. I mean, just a season ago, he was at 8-4. You know, that's what happens. When you start to win and you start to build those expectations, and they want you to compete for championships year in and year out, and outside of Tennessee State being in the OVC, their non-conference schedule is just brutal for the teams they play. We'll talk about that after this snap, and I don't think many people understand the magnitude of their schedule and why it's so tough to win football games down there in Nashville.
Quarterback will keep it himself in another third down as the ball popped loose late on that play. Someone lost a helmet down there. And the clock continues to run. 9.5 to play in our first half.
You see here going on this option right here. In that case there, when you see the running back running that wide open, you should have given him the football there, made
a
poor decision.
That's a read of the quarterback.
Yeah.
I mean, that's his decision whether or not to pull that football back.
That's his read. He's got the best line of vision. The running back just run to where he's supposed to go to, and the quarterback either keeps the ball in his belly or he pulls it out. In that case there, poor decision. And when you make poor decisions, the defense make you pay for it. They were very fortunate to recover the fumble.
That's Thomas in the backfield. He is get to 50 yards and 6 carries. They're 0-for-5 on third down. Play clock is down to 5. They'll work from the shotgun. Play action. Throwing and incomplete. And a flag on the play. Late flag, and you'll have pass interference.
You will have pass interference, but it was very fortunate for Tennessee State. I mean, poor read by the quarterback there. Anytime you've got one wide receiver taking on two defensive backs, you should have gone someplace else with the football. But it looks like one of the DBs might have got there too soon.
Pass interference, defense number 19. 15-yard penalty from the previous spot.
That's Nick Martinez, the strong safety, a redshirt sophomore out of Dade Christian High School in Miami.
Then what happened, the ball was thrown behind him.
Ooh.
And when the wide receiver went to make the body adjustment there, he got that extra push in there. Good defense. Unfortunately, that happens sometimes.
You agree with the call?
You got to call it. You know, you got to call it. Did he stop the wide receiver from making that catch? I say no, but the rule says if you make contact with the guy further than 5 yards down the field, you got to blow the whistle.
Nate Blitz, and boy, does it pay off. It's Perry Burge, sophomore, 6'2", 240 pounds, and also in there was Trevor Frericks.
Big nose tackle. Wow, you see him time that snap. It was almost as if he knew what the snap count was, and he jumped and shot through there like a cannon.
So loss of four on the play. And he's over on the sideline now. Second down and 14. Out of Quincy, transferred from Bowling Green in 07. McNarl works from the shotgun. Incomplete. Intended receiver was Calvin Roberts, so third down and 14.
Well, he was throwing that ball away there as Eastern Illinois ran a stunt from the outside. They brought the defensive end around there to get pressure. You'll see big number 84, Taylor Dunn, coming from around there from his defensive end position right up the middle. So lack of communication by the offensive line of Tennessee State, allowing a defensive lineman to come untouched and get a free hit on your quarterback.
Their longest field goal of the season, if you're wondering, 41 yards, roughly right now about 42-yarder. So they need to get a little distance here, if not that first down.
Blitz.
McNarl throws it up for grabs, and it's incomplete.
When you've got a team that's blitzing, if you have to settle for throwing a fade route, then the defense is one. Percentages, chances of completing fade routes go down dramatically when there's a blitz call there. They're settling for throwing the fade route. They just have not picked up this blitz yet tonight. Every time Eastern Illinois blitzes, they manage to get to the quarterback.
So this will be marked officially a 43-yarder to give the Tigers a lead here in the first quarter. Kick is up, and that's no good. May have been deflected, but had no chance. And the Panthers will take over. ESPNU's coverage of men's college basketball and the Charleston Classic continues later tonight. LaSalle, the Explorers, take on the South Carolina Gamecocks. The Charleston Classic on ESPNU tonight, 9:30 Eastern. For more information, log on to ESPNU.com. So your Facebook question, let's see the answers, or at least some of the things that are happening right now on Facebook.
Yeah, some of my opinion. You know, you've got some unique ones there. You've got the Governors are in this conference. You ever heard of the Governors?
Sure.
Austin P.
But your favorite is? Christensen unloads, and the catch made a pickup of five on the play.
But my answer is, you ask me, hey, what are the best ones? I like the Colonels. Colonels is unique. Eastern Kentucky Colonels. The Skyhawks. Don't know what a Skyhawk is, but I like the way it sounds.
Okay.
And then you got the Racers. Murray State. Murray State's located Kentucky, so it makes sense. Racehorses. So I think they got some creative nicknames here. And Austin P. was my honorable mention choice there, but I like the Colonels.
You like the Colonels?
I like the Colonels. It's like the way it sounds. And tough place to win a football game, too. Traditionally, year in, year out, they're one of the best teams in FCS football.
Second down. Showing blitz. Christensen wants to set up a screen. Deflected and read perfectly up front. That's an outstanding play by the linebacker. He's also, at times, been a defensive lineman. That's Kellen Woodard.
And that's how you teach them. You teach a guy when the offensive lineman is giving you room and letting you get to your quarterback, they may be setting you up for the screen. And once you recognize screen, you look for the running back and try and get between the football and the quarterback. And good job by Kellen Woodard. You can tell he's got good coaching on the defensive side of the ball. And I'm very impressed with this defense. I mean, the defensive coordinator, Rod Reed, is doing a fantastic job with Tennessee State. These guys have some fight in them, and that's what you want on defense.
Third down, big block. And a wide open receiver, and the catch made inside the 45. I'll tell you what. No, they're going to say it's incomplete. And that was Laura who had it and then lost it. And how about the block to give Christensen time to throw? What a block.
Yeah, seal block on the outside. You'll see Jones just go down, and ball was underthrown a little bit, and he was bobbling the ball going down. Never had it. And that's what you got to do. If you can't get to the quarterback, if you can't get to the wide receiver, he was beat, hit him. He bobbled it because he didn't catch it with his hands early on and never had control of that. Good job by the officials. Not a catch.
So the Panthers again will have to punt it away. 7:01 to play in the first half. Another good kick. And it takes a Panther bounce. Look at this. Still rolling inside the 15. And finally touched, it looks like, at the 12. That is a 56-yard kick. Well, you're trying to get that automatic bid, FCS playoffs, and the team that everybody in the country is talking about from the Missouri Valley Conference, the Salukis of Southern Illinois, is Mario Mocha, their outstanding athletic director, who was there for a number of years, went out, got a great head coach. Jerry Kill had been there for years, but Southern Illinois, right now, number one in the land and the team to beat.
Yeah, and they'll probably get that number one seed in postseason. 16 teams get in, 8 at large, and I'll tell you right now, you see the Colonial, those three teams, they'll all get in. Richmond, William and Mary, Villanova, they'll all get in. Last year, the Colonial had 5 teams get in the postseason, so this year, there's talk they may get 6 teams in, and we'll talk some more FCS going down. That's the way it should be.
Yes.
Play for championships on the field. Take it out of the hands of voters. It's not an election. College football is a sport.
And Ward. That was Ward the carry, and Nasty, that's his name, Nasty with the tackle. FCS top 25, and here you go, the coaches poll.
They've got Montana and Southern Illinois. You know, they rotate on who's number one, who's number two, but a lot of people tend to think it's Southern Illinois. They've been doing it for a while. Villanova, Richmond, William & Mary, all out of the CAA. App State, Armani Edwards, fantastic football player, quarterback. South Carolina State, Buddy Pugh's got the MEAC champions up to number 7 in the country. McNeese out of Louisiana. New Hampshire, year in, year out, they're always there. And Elon, the Phoenix, they lost a tough football game to Appalachian State, but they'll be playing in the postseason as well.
Another fine play made by their big man up front, that's Frerix. He's come up with a couple of big plays in the backfield. By the way, FCS fans can watch the playoffs develop, quarterfinal matchups, semifinals, and the final on the ESPN family of networks.
If you're Tennessee State right now, you got a problem on offense. I mean, your center, Sherman Carter's just getting a good old-fashioned tail whooping. He can't block Trevor Frerix. He just can't. I mean, time and time again, we've seen number 99 in the backfield. All he's doing is just beating him one-on-one. They're not blitzing. He's just lining up ahead of him and saying, look, I'm going to beat you. You guys don't have anybody can block me.
Tennessee State will take their second timeout with a 3rd and 16 upcoming. So 5:19 to go in our first half. Eastern Illinois with all their timeouts remaining here in this first half of play. Tennessee State down to 1.
Let's go back to that top 10 if we can. You know, part of the reason I said you'll get at least 5 teams from the Colonial Athletic Conference Association in there, because if you take a look at Villanova, Villanova's got a good contest coming up against number 25, Delaware. And also Montana, they, you know, they don't have a cakewalk. They got to play number 23 ranked Montana State this weekend. And I think with all those teams being in the top 25, they should get in. There are only so many spots. And you take a look at the middle part of the bracket there, Pat Grace, Northern Iowa. And they fell on some tough times, but that team almost knocked off Iowa week one of the season. Then you got South Dakota. And then you look at the bottom half there. You know, I think Colgate and Lafayette are truly on the bubble. I think Lafayette gets in before Colgate. Then Montana State, I think they'll get in, especially if they help their cause. And they may be one of the few teams to get in with 4 losses.
They're 0 for 6 tonight on 3rd down. They'll set up the screen. Defense sniffs it out. Going nowhere, maybe a little breathing room to punt it away as the clock continues to roll with just over 5 minutes to play, and they'll have to kick it.
Can't block them.
Nope.
Can you see that from here?
Oh, yeah.
You can just tell right away, and, you know, we're just in the second quarter, and it's obvious that Tennessee State cannot block just the front 4. So now what happens is we saw earlier where Eastern Illinois was being very aggressive and bringing the blitz. But when they can't block it, you just determine no need to blitz. Let's just go after them with 4.
Flag on the play.
Half the distance to the goal. Still 4th down.
Now we're starting to see, you know, that championship mentality. For Eastern Illinois, they were backed up most of the first quarter, yet they never went backwards. They always tried to move forward. Tennessee State, the same type of challenges faced to them, and they start moving backwards. And now all of a sudden they've lost the battlefield position. And how are they going to hold up? And because the offense couldn't put points on the board, now you're looking at Eastern Illinois getting the football in great field position and really putting a stretch on your defense.
Haynes is standing at the 43-yard line. He'll back up to his own 43. Has a couple of blocks. They set up the wall, cuts it back inside, and tackled at the 45. So finally, Eastern Illinois, the Panthers will have it first and 10 and good field position when we come back. 4:34 to go, first half on the U.
Growing, developing, and exploring.
All right, Lowell, thanks. Got your game face on, you ready to go?
Oh, man, Charles Arbuck, I like own him.
Talk a little trash, huh?
Back it up.
That ball was fumbled, it looked like, late, but they said he was down. I want to go back to something I brought up before with Southern Illinois, and people are saying, wait a minute, the Salukis, number one in the land? One of the reasons that they're doing so well is you take a look at what Mario Mocha, who is considered one of the great young athletic directors in all of the United States, has done. It's about raising money and facilities. And if you can do that, as you well know, you get kids that you couldn't get 5 years ago.
And then when you have the ability to do that from the athletic director position, you allow your coaches to go out and coach. That's what they want to do. They don't have to do all the fundraising. They should have a partnership, but athletic director can raise money and get new facilities and good hires. That's what you judge them by.
They're looking deep. Christensen had a man in and out of the hands, but it's a flag.
They went back.
He was going for Lawrence Ricks.
Now that's one there where I would say they went back and forth. I mean, one pushed them with one, the other one pushed the other. They went back and forth. Now it becomes subjective, and you know, it's kind of which defender has the best body English. That's how you got to sell it. When it's that close, you got to sell it and act like, hey, he pushed me.
Pass interference, defense, number 26. 15-yard penalty from the previous spot. Automatic first down.
I mean, there's a push right there in the blue jersey. You see him push right there in the blue. Then they had a hold, so they were going back and forth. I just think that's a football play. See, he's pushing, trying to separate, and yes, he's got his hands on him, but they're going back and forth there. It just looks like a football play every now and then.
So the ball is at the 29-yard line. Panthers finally trying to get something going here in this first half of play. Christensen with time, and the lefty throws a strike to the 5-yard line. They'll have it first and goal. Boy, that was right in the stride of Laura, the freshman from Miami. That's a 26-yard pickup.
And Laura does a good job of coming all the way across the formation. Starts on the left, comes all the way across to the right. Offensive line gave him time. Slow development play there as they flooded the zone on the weak side. You see another strike thrown by Christensen hitting Laura in stride. Good team's going to make you pay when they get good field position. Eastern Illinois has proven they're a good football team. Give an opportunity, have a short field, and they're going to make you pay.
Christensen, 7-12, and 67 yards in our first half of play. End zone, incomplete. And again, he was trying to hook up with Ricks.
They've got a little battle going over there between Ricks and Marquez Hall, one-on-one. Who wants it more? When you throw this fade pattern, it should be thrown towards the back pylon. You see he missed the pylon over there on the left side of your screen, so he underthrew that football a little bit. Throw it out there a little bit more. Allow Ricks to make an easier catch.
Second and goal. The ball is on the 3. They'll hand it off, and they'll be short. That was Mon Williams again. And a real big play now with third and goal.
Mon Williams, that's their thunder backfield, if you want to have a thunder and lightning thing, when you bring Williams in and then you bring in Jimmy Potempa. And Williams, one of those guys, they like him going running straight ahead. He's the power runner, but no place to go there. Yards get a little tough to come by once you get in the red zone.
They're 1-for-5 tonight on third down. That's a look at the season for Eastern Illinois inside the 20. Third and goal. Same route, incomplete. That's Ricks again that they tried to do that little fade to the corner.
Yeah, and that time you see he tried to make the adjustment and throw the ball more to the sideline, but in that case there, missed the back pylon.
And, Jay, if you're Tennessee State, you're saying, I realize we're probably going to give up 3 points after this next play, but in a way it's a victory when you had it on the 3-yard line in first and goal.
Yeah, they show their mettle there. Considering any time a team gets the ball on your side of the field, you just say, hey, let's limit them to a field goal attempt. Let's not give up the touchdown, and the defense rose to the challenge.
20-yard attempt here. Austin Signer kicks it through, and finally the Panthers get on the board with 2:23 to go. So you said you've got your game face going, and here we go. Jay Walker and Charles Arbuckle coming up at the half with the college pick'em.
I'm up by 20 points on them, and you think I'm worried? Come on, man.
ESPN.com/fantasy and games to join in.
Season's running down a little bit, but, I mean, Buck, I'll give you credit. He beat me by 7 points last week, so, you know, he didn't lay down. You know, he didn't lay down. Normally tight ends, you know, they're in between kind of. He's a former tight end. So basically, Buck is like average. You know, the national average is 412. He's a 415. I'm 435. I'm in the top 7% in the country. This is what I do here on ESPNU.
Jay, I don't think you need, as you mentioned before, an agent.
I'm my own hype man, huh?
You're your own hype machine. I'm telling you. The drive was 6 plays, 41 yards. It took 2 minutes, 11 seconds, and a 20-yard field goal. And the Panthers lead it by the score of 3-0. How do you get going if you're Tennessee State offensively? What needs to happen?
You know, protect your quarterback for one. You've got to do that. And then take some deep shots. I mean, when you've got an offense that you obviously don't have the ability to move the ball down the field, then do take a page out of the Eastern Illinois book. Throw the ball downfield deep. Maybe get a couple penalties to help you out, pass interference. But, you know, they can't continue to try and nickel and dime this team because they don't seem like they have the ability to maintain a long offensive drive. Not with the personnel they have right now. They've got too many freshmen playing that offensive line, freshmen in the running back, penalties here or there. They got to just take some D shots and let it all go.
Kick will be taken inside the 10 at the 8-yard line. Ooh, big hit down there at the 20 with 2:18 to go. Return of 12 yards on that play. Saturday college football, our lineup on ESPNU. Noon, it's Duke at number 20, Miami. 3:30, NC State at number 15, Virginia Tech. Vanderbilt at Tennessee. Lane Kiffin has had some problems this week. And Nevada at New Mexico State.
He said, hey, we didn't have an incident in 11 months, 11 days. And so
kiss
he said,
death.
Kiss of death. It's like, it's like watching a basketball player. He hasn't missed a free throw in 90 attempts. Well, you know, on that 91st attempt, he normally misses.
Right.
That's what happened to Tennessee.
McNarl will hand it off. And that'll go to Travis Ward. Now,
if you're timeout here, if I'm Eastern Illinois.
I was just about to say that. If you're Eastern Illinois, you've got 3 timeouts to burn. You feel that they're not going to move the ball against you. And all of a sudden, you're going to find yourself in decent field position if they have to kick it away.
Yeah, and I'm a little surprised they haven't taken the timeout here, especially when a team only gets 1 yard on that first down. That means, you know, the odds are in your favor. You know conservative play calling is coming, but who am I to question a coach that's been there forever?
And that's Ward in the backfield. He'll play action to him. McNarl to the sideline, catch made. And stepping out of bounds was Julian Sample, the wide receiver from Vegas.
Now, doesn't he look like a genius that he didn't call timeout? After they get a first down, he said, see, they got a fresh set of downs. Now I'm going to need those timeouts. And good job by McNarl getting out the pocket, keeping his vision downfield, and finding Julian Sample there on the sideline. And one thing you like if you're Julian Sample, you know, better coach team, you know, knowing the down distance and the situation, you don't necessarily want to step out of bounds. Keep that clock running. But he's thinking they're in a two-minute offense like they're in the aggressive mode when realistically they were in what we like to call the four-minute offense. Just pick up 2 first downs and milk the clock.
Please reset the game clock to 1 minute, 37 seconds. 1 minute, 37.
A little confusion on the sideline where the spot of the ball was, and that's why the clock continued to run. And when he stepped out of bounds, if they needed to come out and measure. So they add the extra ticks on the clock at 1:37. This will be a first and 10 as they did get that first down. Little handoff up the middle and a tackle at the 35-yard line. And that's Thomas this time.
Man, just take a look here. You see the penetration there, number 99 in the backfield again, but one good thing about a solid football team, if the D-line doesn't get you, the offense is the linebackers are going to get you, and Gordy Kickle's playing that inside linebacker position. And you know what I like on the stats that really showed up? The top three tacklers on this Eastern Illinois team are the middle linebacker, the outside linebacker, and the other outside linebacker. No safeties in the mix. They just get it done the good old-fashioned way with three linebackers that like to hit and tackle.
Showing blitz on the outside. They get there quickly and going nowhere. They lost a yard on that play with 50 seconds to go in our first half. Now they will take that timeout, I believe. Let's see if they do.
Yeah, they're going to get a timeout call there. Here's something I want to know from you. I like to know. You know, I get a little too emotionally involved sometimes. Heisman Trophy's up for grabs. Now, who do you think is going to win the Heisman Trophy?
It's a great question. I mean, at this point, I don't see a clear-cut favorite right now. I mean, I love the running back from Bama. I mean, I think Tebow will be in the conversation. Two kids, Colt McCoy and his wide receiver out of Texas. You got to look in that direction. How about you?
I think right now, at this date, it's Mark Ingram's to lose because the quarterbacks haven't stepped up.
Yes.
You know, as much as I like Tebow and he wins over and over again, he just doesn't have Heisman Trophy numbers. I mean, if he were to get the Heisman Trophy this season with the numbers he has, I don't know what you're saying out there. I mean, the numbers just look kind of bad. They don't look very Heisman-like. And Ingram, he's had those performances you need to capture America's mind from the very first week in the season when he carried that Alabama team to a victory against Virginia Tech.
Right.
In the second half. Last week, had the gash on him and had the blood all over him. And you saw the blood, he had the 70-yard runs. Those are those Heisman moments that you need to have, which kind of signature a Heisman-type season. Would you agree with that?
I would, and I think what's getting overlooked a little bit, maybe Jordan Shipley. Not a lot of people talk about him. Special teams guy, favorite target for Colt McCoy. Now, I don't think he'll be in that running, but you asked me about guys that could be in that conversation. I think he would be in it, but I'm with you. I mean, Alabama, what they've done this year and what he's done has just been remarkable.
And what happens, to win a Heisman, you need the whole athletic department to get behind you.
Yeah.
They were all behind Colt McCoy early.
Exactly.
And Colt struggled a little bit. You know, guy
before
coming
the
on
snap,
late.
Delay a game on the offense. 5-yard penalty. Still third down. Please reset the game clock to 47.7 seconds.
And a guy who's coming on late, who's probably playing the best football in America right now, is C.J. Spiller. I mean, have they not had struggled out the gates? I mean, C.J., to me, he's proven he's the best college football player in the country. But just got off to such a late start, and I don't know if he's got enough momentum to get him through so late.
Eastern Illinois trying to get a stop here. They've got two timeouts remaining. McNarl
ran out of bounds.
Yeah, steps out of bounds. And that'll bring up a fourth down with 41.5 seconds remaining. And it's a gain of eight. So now, Jay, here's a question. Do you go after this kick, or do you try to set up a big return?
I'd go for the return. I mean, and the reason being, if you get a pretty decent return, they've got a kicker with a strong leg, one of the best kickers in the country, 6'3", 215 pounds, and he was booming them from 60-plus yards. And you go for the return, and in college football, with two timeouts, that's an eternity. You
yes.
can run your whole offense.
Haynes to receive it. Lets it bounce. Takes a favorable bounce for the Panthers, and they'll have it with the ball at the 32-yard line with 33.2 seconds remaining. And they've got two timeouts. 34-yard kick. Award show coming up. Home Depot ESPNU College Football Award Show. That's December 10th. They'll be down in Florida. Red carpet show at 6 Eastern right here on the U.
Your boy Shipley, I'm sure Shipley will be there for the Biletnikoff Award.
Yep.
Right there on the top of the list. And so many awards now. I mean, you can almost have a here's the award, name that award. Davey O'Brien, my favorite award, given to the number one gunslinger in the country, the quarterback.
Yeah. Christensen with time over the middle and in and out of the hands of the intended receiver. Hit him right in the numbers, and he was looking for Lawrence Ricks. It's been his favorite target so far today.
That's been his go-to guy there. Unfortunately for Christensen, he put that ball in a bad spot, right in his hands. He dropped it. You got to make him go get it, I guess. That's one that Ricks has to come down with, and nobody wishes he had that catch more than Jake Christensen. But You can tell there, team's starting to get conservative. You got to think if you're Tennessee State, keep your foot on the gas pedal. Your defense has been doing a fantastic job. Keep it up with the pressure.
After a quick start, Christensen now is two of his last nine. From the shotgun again, they're showing blitz, and all of a sudden they have a screen set up. If that was clean, you're looking at a big gain and a late flag on the play.
That would have been a huge play. I mean, that's the perfect call. If you're going to get blitz and pressure, you want to get a screen pass.
Flag was thrown from that far sideline. Not sure if we didn't see a face mask there. Let's see. Jason MacArthur, our referee.
Personal foul, face mask. Number 10 on the defense. The 15-yard penalty will be added to the end of the run. Automatic first down.
When you got teams that are in four-game losing streaks, they do things like that.
So they'll have one timeout remaining. So take me inside that huddle for Eastern Illinois and what their head coach is thinking right here. You're in your two-minute offense, obviously, but do you go with any kind of shots down the middle, or is everything to the sideline to try to step out of bounds?
The sake that, you know, in college football, one, when you get a first down, they're going to stop the clock just to set the chains, and if you don't get up there quick enough, you do have that timeout that you can use. But so right now, you've got your whole playbook available to you. I think what you're doing right now is you're talking with your offensive coordinator, Roy Wicke, and he's in the ear of Christensen saying, hey, we need to pick up another 15 yards so we can get a field goal attempt. And right now you're just trying to calculate how much leg does my kicker have, how much yards do I need to get, and that will determine how aggressive you need to be during these last 20 seconds.
If you're wondering, the longest has been a 48-yarder this season.
He's got more leg than that.
As we've seen.
Yes.
We saw that in warm-ups too.
Austin Signal is a good one. 6'4", 220-pound place kicker. And that ball just flies off his foot. So right now you're just trying to get him in a position to possibly put some more points on the board.
So you're talking about trying to get 20 more yards and a chance at a real long field goal. But realistic. Got about 15 of them right there. There's the first down.
Right there. So the clock is going to stop right now. Still on the 13 seconds. And they can set it, go up there, kill the ball. So you still have your timeout. This is a good use of this no-huddle, hurry-up, two-minute offense. Yeah, I mean, that's a good job. When you got a team like that and it only takes you 1 second to kill the ball, you can tell this is stuff that they've done in practice. They're used to being in these situations. Good job of coaching by Roy Wicke, the offensive coordinator. And when you got veteran coaches like Bob Spoo there, he's seen it all. He knows what it takes to win football games in any way, shape, or form.
So 12.3 to go first half. And again, they still have that one timeout in their back pocket. This will be second down and 10 with the ball on the 36. They'll drop back in coverage here. Good protection. Down to 7 seconds. He'll throw. And it is incomplete. Lots now you've got 4.4 seconds. This is roughly 54, 55 yards right here. Again, the long is 48 this season for their kicker. And with 4.4, there's no chance that they could have one play and then try to get the timeout. So they'll attempt the long field goal here and try to go in at halftime with a 6-0 lead.
I'm going to make a prediction on this field goal. He won't be short. He's got plenty of leg. Now, left, right, that's the variable here, but
so
watch this ball fly off his foot.
Measured at 53 yards. Tennessee State will try to ice him. So they'll take their final timeout of the half with the 4 seconds on the clock.
I'm going to take a look, good look there at Jim Webster, the head coach of Tennessee State. And you know, just think about it. You go 8-4 a season ago. You think you're on cloud nine. To be at the point he is now where, you know, and I'll talk on this, is the fact that they had a newspaper article that came out about 2 weeks ago that said that they were going to make a coaching change at Tennessee State. How unfair was that to that program? to the kids involved in the program. You're reading stuff on the internet saying your coach got fired, then it wasn't true, and you put in all the speculation there, and imagine the coaching circumstances.
Trying to recruit.
Yes.
Because you know the other kids are, the other schools out there going for those kids are going to use that against you.
Yep.
I mean, you know that's going to happen. And you mentioned, you know, they've had some close calls this year. Well, they had 21-17, a loss at Southern.
Southern's a very good football team.
They lost a 9-6 game to Murray State. And their most recent game was 24-21 that they lost. So very tight games. 53-yard attempt right here. Maybe long enough. Nope, to the left and no good. And the first half comes to a close with Eastern Illinois just a 3-0 lead here in Charleston, Illinois. Now we head to the studio for SportsCenter U, Lo Galindo, Charles Arbuckle, standing by.
Dan, thank you so much. Coming up, we'll tell you about Oklahoma State. Alex Kate has yet to throw his first pass as a starting quarterback for the Cowboys. We'll let you know how he already has an early lead. The highlights coming up from Stillwater.
In the Division I Football Championship subdivision, it's not about the number on the jersey or the name on the back. In the FCS, it's about passion, teamwork, and school spirit. But most of all, it's about integrity, honor, and respect. In Division I football, it's all about sportsmanship. We are the Division I FCS. 12,000 student athletes, 118 universities, and 13 conferences. This is where sportsmanship happens.
So, we start with a frozen burger. Cold as ice. Just grab it and throw it on the grill. Let her fly. Just flick it.
Want a fresh cooked hamburger?
Flick. You're getting it.
Then get Wendy's single, double, or triple with hot, juicy North American beef. Fresh cooked, not frozen like the other guys. Because real is how we cook it. You know when it's real.
What's up with that?
Well, the Washington State alums can't make it in this week, so.
Well, if you like defense, you're in the right spot here on ESPNU. First half, we saw three total points as number 13, Eastern Illinois, is trying to wrap up the title outright in the OVC as they lead Tennessee State. And, Jay, I'm glad you've settled down from your segment from halftime, but one of the things to look at is that with TSU, seven possessions, six punts, and one blocked field goal for Eastern Illinois, seven possessions, four punts, a fumble, a missed field goal, and one field goal. This has been a defensive battle, to say the least.
It has been. And normally when the score is like this, you're saying, wow, the offensive play is very sloppy. But in this case, I'm really going to just give my hats off to the defense. Both of these defenses came to play. For Eastern Illinois, they've been led by Trevor Frericks. He was a dominating performer from his defensive tackle position in the first half. And Tennessee State, linebacker by committee, with John Jones doing a good job and Rico Council helping out.
That's a low line drive kick and taken at the 5-yard line. That's Chris Wright, one of the backup wide receivers, and a short return on that play. Jay Walker, Dan McLaughlin with you, and defense, the name of the game there in that first half.
It was, and it was good defensive play. I don't mind seeing good defensive play as long as it's not sloppy offense. In this case, the defense was just winning. In the game of football, you have to respect your opponent sometimes.
Did you calm down from your halftime segment?
Oh, man, wasn't that fun? I mean, Buck can't hang with me. Come on, man.
It's fun for you.
Champ.
It's not fun for him.
I'm in the top 7%. You know, it's like I'm getting an eighth grade out. He's average at best, as the numbers show.
It is a chilly night, as you might imagine, here in the middle of America. We're in Eastern Illinois, Charleston, Illinois.
Good run.
Williams is the ball here.
Julian Sample hit on the stop. Some of the highlights, and it's been defense.
Yeah, pressure there. You see the sack, that caused the fumble. Great field position for the Tigers, but they cannot put points on the board. And for Eastern Illinois, right up the middle. Talking about Trevor Frericks lining up at his defensive tackle position and just penetrating in the backfield at will. Looks like a grown man going against a little boy there. He's winning his one-on-one matchup.
They went with Mon Williams on that last play. Second down and two. They'll keep it on the ground. They pick up the first down with Williams to the outside. And finally knocked out of bounds at the 44-yard line. Mon Williams with a good carry.
That's back-to-back carries by Mon Williams, in which he's shown us two different things. The first carry showed the moves and the shake. This is what he's known for. Give him the thunder. Get to the outside. Bounce off somebody. Can't arm tackle a strong runner. Making the first defender work hard to get him down and going to the second defender, delivering the blows and being a punishing, bruising running back. That's the thunder.
It's a pickup of 13 on that play. Just underway, second half. O'Brien Field in Charleston, Illinois. The Panthers trying to wrap up the conference championship with a win. Big hole, left side. Williams, but closing that speed. The gap there. And a nice play with Smith. Take a look at first half stats. And the rushing yards, along with the passing yards. I mean, is there anything right now that looks good statistically for either side?
Yeah, they got a pretty good punter over there at Eastern Illinois, 48.8 yeah. average. And, you know, the money down is where they're missing it. Third down conversions, we've only seen one third down conversion this evening, and that's why you've only seen 3 points on the board. They've got to convert on the money down. Third down efficiency is the most crucial statistic in offensive football.
With runs in motion. Christensen throwing across his body and into double coverage and an easy play. That's tough for a lefty to be rolling to his right, and that was picked off by Tyron Johnson, senior out of Richmond, California, and Laney Community College.
Yeah, the pressure by Kellen Ward. Watch number 53. He's going to go. He knows he's going to get blocked through the running back blocking him, but doesn't allow the quarterback to step into the throw, making it an easy interception for Tyron Johnson going up and grabbing that ball out at the highest point.
And, Jay, for people that have just tuned in, you know, for Christensen and this offense and this team, if they win tonight, conference championship, you're looking at the playoffs, it's the final game for the seniors, all those things wrapped into one, and they just have not played well here at home.
Man, where's the fire? It seems like something's missing in their belly, and what you got to do is throw records out the window and realize that this is a matchup problem for this team, and for them to win, it would be tough because this Tennessee State came last season when they went down to Nashville. Tennessee State manhandled them, put 47 points on them, and they haven't forgot that. And that's what the coaches thought, that this year Eastern Illinois has a lot more riding on it, and they're going to come out ready to play more and fire them up, but they just haven't been able to do it. They're still winning that battle of the line of scrimmage, y'all.
They sure are.
Tennessee State doesn't look like they went there, made any halftime adjustments on the offensive line. And sometimes you can't make adjustments when you just don't have the talent to compete in the trenches, which they don't have right now.
Eastern Illinois has won 7 of the last 9 meetings between the schools.
Look,
McNarl keeps it himself, and then they'll wrap him up.
The quarterback draw.
McNarl, the ball carrier.
4 people in the backfield. I mean, the penetration.
Jay, the guy to me that has just been unbelievable tonight. Where's number 99? He's right over the ball. That's Trevor Frericks.
Yeah, you see, look at the push. Look at the surge. I mean, you've got blue jerseys. Keep in mind, this was a design run. So it wasn't like they were pass blocking. They knew they were going to come off the ball with the draw. And they just, like I said, can't block them. Sometimes football's that simple. You either can block them or you can't. They can't block them.
Third down and 13 with the ball on the 26. Roll him out to his right side. McDonald brought down inside the 20 and tackled at the 18.
Now, the defensive line is going to get the credit for the sack, but this was a fantastic job by the cornerback for Eastern Illinois, number 21, C.J. James. He's coming from the outside. Once he sees pressure coming, his job is to make the quarterback pull up. You see him right there on the left side of your screen. Once you force the quarterback to stop and pull up on a rollout, look at him. You see him right here. He's coming. No, you're not getting outside of me. Force the quarterback back on the inside, and it was just a gang tackle from there. Good defense.
Rashad Haynes standing at midfield. They come after it. Kick is away. Haynes backs up. And tremendous coverage that time by Tennessee State and a kick of 36 yards. We'll step aside. 10:47 to play in our third quarter. Eastern Illinois at home on senior night with just a 3-point lead.
Before you ever love it, the Nissan Altima goes through over 5,000 tests. No wonder J.D. Power and Associates ranked it highest in initial quality. The new Nissan Altima, quality you can love.
What's up with that?
Well, the Washington State alums can't make it in this week, so I'm going to keep their streak alive.
Isn't that like cheating, though?
Well, Des, this is game day, and there's the Washington State flag.
Well, technically, that's a tchotchke.
Now, Chris, technically, that's a flag.
Think you know? Text CGD to 43776. ESPN College Game Day, built by the Home Depot, Saturdays at 10 a.m.
...1978 Division II National Champions right here, Eastern Illinois. They did it back in 78, and a chance to win the OVC tonight. And once you get into that playoff, boy, as you well know, Jay, anything can happen.
Yeah, and you know, in the Ohio Valley, the winner of the conference gets an automatic bid in the postseason play. If Eastern Illinois were to lose tonight and Eastern Kentucky were to upset Jacksonville State, then the Colonels from Eastern Kentucky would be the representative from the Ohio Valley going to the postseason play.
A stick on the ground this time. Gang tackled at the 47-yard line, they'll call it. Jay Walker, the former NFL quarterback alongside. I'm Dan McLaughlin. College football primetime on ESPNU. Bryant Field in Charleston, Illinois. Tennessee State, it's been a struggle this year at 3-7. Eastern Illinois, what's at stake for them? Outright OVC title with the win, and Tennessee State maybe playing for their coach, his future, and trying to snap their four-game losing streak. Handoff. And a tackle at the 49. So here we go again on third down.
That's what happens. We have these lightning running backs. You got the thunder and the lightning. And, you know, Potempa is the lightning. He runs very fast and in a hurry. But when he gets hit, he goes down in a hurry, too. Doesn't have a lot of mass behind him. 5'7", 170 pounds. You can arm tackle a guy like that and slow him down.
So third and five with just over 9.5 to go, third quarter. After a very quick start, Christensen has struggled a bit. Has protection here, lofts it to the sideline, wide open, catch made. They'll mark him out at the 26-yard line.
This was a blown coverage.
That's Kenny Whitaker, the flanker. He's only a freshman. They say he's got tremendous speed.
Yeah, they played pure zero coverage, and nobody guarded. Nobody was on guard for the wide receiver there. Wide open, running by himself, and they just missed. You see him just taking his time there, and he knew he was getting close to out of bounds, so tiptoe, tiptoe. It's college football, young man. You only need one.
So big pickup on that play. Will stay on the ground. Reversing direction. Looking for a block. He won't get it. Late flag, though. Over on that far sideline near that 30-yard line. This very well could be a hold after a reverse direction. Sometimes you'll see that.
That's what happens. You expose the whole offensive line, and they're not ready for the change of direction. Feel the defenders getting away from them so often, they just grab a little bit of that jersey.
Still waiting for our call from down below. It looks like it will indeed be against Eastern Illinois. That could take them out of field goal range.
Well, this is interesting. I don't know if you take it considering the yardage that was lost on the play.
I agree.
Well, if he had even got back to the line of scrimmage, then you want to take the penalty. But in this case, since he lost yardage, go ahead and make it second down. You don't want to give a potent offense an opportunity to have an extra snap. But sooner or later, you got to make up your mind.
Holding. Offense. Number 89. The penalty is declined. It'll be second down.
And that hold will go against Danny Vejovic, the tight end out of Rochester. So, second down and 18. Nullifies the gain. We just just saw moments ago. Christensen, flushed out of the pocket, has to run, tucks it, and a short pickup on the play.
Once again, getting pressure in the backfield was Kellen Woodard, number 53. You kind of see him all over the football field. He's got that motor, and he's beating his man one-on-one, forcing the quarterback to leave the pocket. See, they've got one guy on the outside, then right when he thinks he gets away, 53 just lurking right there behind him. So good job by the defensive line, front seven for Tennessee State.
Tennessee State, when they have blitzed, almost every time, it's been at the right time. It's been the good calls.
And that's the key. You know, I always say, if you're going to blitz a quarterback, you better get to him. And when they blitz the quarterback, they manage to get to him.
Third and 16. Steps up, looking, can't find anybody, and then finally brought down. And that's at the 28-yard line.
Well, I'm very impressed with this defensive unit from Tennessee State. They've got the ability in the secondary to guard guys one-on-one. They don't have to play zone coverage. They can play man-to-man coverage and cover you. And you figure when you produce cornerbacks like Dominic Rogers, Cromartie, in the secondary, you can get it done. And for years, they've had a number of good defensive backs that have come out of Tennessee State. That hasn't changed. Good job by the secondary coach of getting them coached up, because these receivers have been covered like blankets.
45-yard attempt here. This young man from 40 to 49 yards this season is 5 of 10. High snap. Kick is blocked again. They'll just get away from it. And how about Tennessee State trying to pull off an upset tonight, playing for their coach, trying to play spoiler as well. And Eastern Illinois, their struggles continue. 7:03, third quarter, and Professor J coming up when we come back.
College campus in Moorhead, Kentucky, comes a story of hope, action, excitement, and adventure. A story where your dreams can take root and grow. A story that begins with you. Come visit Moorhead State University. Successful alumni now appearing everywhere. This university is rated one of the top public universities in the South by U.S. News and World Report.
Here's the men's room marathon.
Going over and over.
Now the night games.
Waking up to go.
These guys should see their doctors.
Those could be urinary symptoms due to BPH and enlarged prostate.
But for many guys, prescription Flomax reduces their urinary symptoms due to BPH in 1 week. Only your doctor can tell if you have BPH, not a more serious condition like prostate cancer.
When taking Flomax, avoid driving or hazardous tasks until you know how Flomax will affect you, as a sudden drop in blood pressure may occur, rarely resulting in fainting.
Tell your doctor about all medications you take. If considering cataract surgery, tell your eye surgeon you've taken Flomax.
Common side effects are runny nose, dizziness, and decrease in semen. Ask your doctor if Flomax is right for you.
For many men, Flomax can make a difference in 1 week.
Struggling with credit card debt? Are you worried about making your monthly payments? Stop the harassing calls. Legally reduce your debt. Feel the freedom of debt-free living. Call the Financial Future Network now and secure your family's future today.
Somewhere in the sky, miles and miles above the Earth, the space shuttle Atlantis is in orbit. The pilot of the space shuttle Atlantis is a gentleman by the name of Barry Wilmore. Ohio Valley Conference fans may remember him as being the star linebacker for the Tennessee Tech in 1985 when he led the conference in tackles. Did you know that?
I guarantee you did not know that until you read a book.
Hey, that's why you go to Howard University. I like that story because, you know, football players, we always think they want to hit, especially linebackers, they just hit, but you got Professor teaching you about aerodynamics and all this other stuff. I mean, to think the pilot of a space shuttle that's in orbit right now was a former football player.
Yeah.
Football players do anything.
It said Travis Ward with the carry that time. Little pitch out to him. Tennessee State. Let's see if they just start pitching the ball a little bit and using their speed to the outside. Nothing else is working.
I say you got to try some deep drive. You know, go ahead, throw it up. You know, you got a quarterback. If he can throw 50 yards in the air, 60 yards, that's just like a punt. You may come down with it. If it's intercepted, you weren't going to get the first down anyway the way it's been going. So take some chances. Get out your comfort zone.
Second and four. And a first down. Once again, that's more the quick back that they have. They've got a couple, as you mentioned, Jay, but this kid right here is really quick.
I mean, Tennessee State is one of the few teams that's had a 2,000-yard rusher before, Charles Anthony, so they know how to run the football historically. It's up front. You see runs like that and plays like that, you think, okay, they should be able to do it over and over again, but the problem has been they cannot sustain a drive.
That was Kickles with the tackle, his fifth of the night. Under 6.5 to go, third quarter of play. 3-0, our score. Showing blitz. They'll stay on the ground. Slight hole this time, and still on his feet, Travis Ward.
See this flash.
Just that little daylight he had.
That great running back show you talk about. All they need is a little bit of daylight and that flash. He gets to the hole in a hurry. You see him there, turn sideways and accelerate quickly through the hole, leaning forward, getting that extra yard. Once you're at second and one, advantage offense.
Averaging just about 4 yards a carry tonight. Inside Panther territory. They stack the box this time. Now you've got coverage one-on-one. Whoa. There it is. Nice catch. And still on his feet, Marquez Wilkins. That's a great job of play calling by Tennessee State. They stack the box, anticipating the run. That gives you one-on-one coverage, and they were able to take advantage of it.
It was, and it helps when you got a mobile quarterback that can outrun a strong safety coming in on the blitz on the outside. Very dangerous throw, but McNarl had enough arm strength to squeeze it in there. You see Marquez Wilkins trying to get some extra yards, those yak yards, we call them, yards after the catch. Right now, Tennessee State's on the prowl.
Ward is in the backfield. Gets the carry, little hesitation, spinning, and down inside the 10.
Is this offense?
It is.
Tennessee State showing us what offense is supposed to look like. Set it up with the pass to loosen them up, and then you get a running back that's starting to feel it and getting a groove, and you like seeing the enthusiasm of war. You know, feed me, coach. I want the ball. All great running backs want the ball.
Seventh in the conference inside the red zone with touchdowns. Ward, 11 carries, 46 yards. This has been his drive.
Feed him.
He gets it again. Tackled at the 5. Depending on the spot, could be a first down. It was second and 2.
They're in a very good situation right now. They're able to pick up a first down inside the 10-yard line. Pick it up, get a fresh set of downs, and really have this Panther defense on the ropes.
And really, if you get the first down, you're talking about being inside the 5. So you'd have it first and goal inside the 5, and they'll bring the chains out. Looks like we'll have a measurement.
This is a good sign of that fight that these boys from Nashville brought with them here tonight. Everything's saying just last game of the year, go ahead and let it go. Too much pride to do that, too much fight.
Charleston, Illinois, and they're just short. It's about 2.5 hours or so outside of St. Louis, a couple of hours from Indianapolis, not too far from Champaign either, home of the Fighting Illini.
You see right there on that run, there was a hole that was right there, but as so many freshmen do, they want to run to the outside and bounce it. They start falling in love with bouncing plays to the outside. When you get down the goal line, follow your fullback. Always a good thing if you follow your fullback. Let's see if Ward learned from his mistake and he'll follow his fullback.
Third and inches. Play action has a man. They got the first down.
What a hit.
Just shy of the goal line. What a hit is right after the catch was made by Ronald Bright.
Woo! That's football there.
You like that, huh?
Oh, man, I don't like getting hit now. Let's not get it twisted now. I'm a quarterback, but you know, when you got a guy like Ronald Bright who was a linebacker, they converted him and he plays fullback just in these short yarded situations. So, you know, he's not running from contact. And when you get a bruiser linebacker in there in the backfield, you want him to go hit somebody. And that's what he did.
A sneak. No indication yet. Now they do. Touchdown. Tennessee State trying to pull off a huge upset tonight, and they have the lead 6-3 now with 3:39 to play in our third quarter.
I think they woke up this Eastern Illinois team. What do you do here? Hey, quarterback sneak. Wedge it, get it, everybody push. Find a spot, plant your body low, and push into the end zone.
Think about the first drive of the second half. It was Eastern Illinois. They had the football, moving it a little bit, and Tennessee State came up with a stop. All of a sudden, the momentum just kind of stopped again.
And it also goes back to going into the halftime. They stopped them from putting the points on
yes.
the board. Time and time again, this defense, anytime they've been challenged, they still managed to rise to the occasion and limit Eastern Illinois to just field goal attempts.
This team, are they playing for their coach? Some believe so. Tennessee State 7-3 on the road tonight.
Attending college is one of the most important decisions you'll ever make. So when making that decision, consider this. U.S. News and World Report ranks Murray State University as one of the best public institutions in the nation. We offer a unique residential college style of living in a safe campus environment. We offer small class sizes for a better learning experience. We offer great value for the money with a national reputation for academic excellence. Murray State University, your world to explore.
Hi, Billy Mays here for the Toll Bandit. When two hands just aren't enough, reach for the Toll Bandit. It's a lightweight magnetic band that provides a safe, secure place to hold all your tools and parts. Wrenches, screwdrivers, nuts, nails, and bolts, even a heavy hammer, all at the same time. Any job, big or small, the Toll Bandit tackles them all. Who needs a toolbox when all you need is the Toll Bandit?
The Toll Bandit makes a great gift for any hobbyist or do-it-yourselfer. Toll Bandit is available at these participating retailers.
Put your hands up! Ready! UCLA, fight, fight, fight!
What your engine feels, you feel. And when it's running clean, you feel it. Which is why we developed full synthetic Pennzoil Platinum with active cleansing agents that clean out up to 46% of sludge in your first oil change and continue to clean in your next change. Pennzoil Platinum Motor Oil, our ultimate clean for your ultimate feeling. Not just oil, Pennzoil.
Meet Bob. Bob's helping us see where it's easier to find money, in there or when you compare auto insurance prices at Esurance. Fill out one easy online form for real-time prices from Esurance and other leading companies. Then Esurance helps you buy from the place that saves you the most. How much you got?
$53.
Good work. But Esurance is a better one-stop shop to find cash. Drivers who compare rates at Esurance save $451 a year on average. Find your cash in minutes at Esurance.
James Webster and his crew with a 7-3 lead, and some of the emotion there on that sideline.
I mean, look at this. You see the players over there on the sideline. Look, they're not quitting. Look at that. Hello, man. Uh-oh, Dan, I'm getting hyped up. I want to go down on the field. That hypes me up.
A short kick, fielded at the 25, and a tackle at the 33. And so Eastern Illinois, the Panthers, heavily favored in this game. They got to get something going here.
They really do need to. And I mean, let's look at the big picture. This is not the way you want to end your regular season. You know, if they come back and win the game, that's great. But if they make it into postseason play, they've got room for improvement. Field goal game hasn't been there tonight. The offense has struggled at times. And don't think when you get to postseason play, you're not going to see the same looks that Tennessee State has given you fits with this tonight.
3:35 to go. Christensen, play action, rolling to his right. Can't find a man, and he's going to be brought down. Still on his feet, but finally tackled at the 30. Loss of three on the play, and a little bit careless with the football, too. If he takes a pretty good hit, that ball's coming loose.
You thought it was going to be a fumble there at some point, but you also got to think you're outside the pocket. When you've got this much time, it's either an incomplete pass or nothing. Not a sack in any way, shape, or form. And get rid of the football. You're in a tough football game right now. These yards are coming at a premium, and they're very tough to come by. And you see right now, it looks as if Jake Christensen's a little bit not showing that smooth calmness he had about him like he did early in this football game.
It was Calvin Baker who brought him down. Second and 12. Little trick play here as they reverse it the other way. The speed to the outside. And knocking him out of bounds was Anthony Levine, the defensive back out of Winston-Salem, North Carolina. Pickup of 10 on the play. There's a good example of the speed of Laura, the wide receiver.
Good job of play selection called there. When you've got a team that's very aggressive, give them some misdirection, and then becomes a foot race to the outside. You'll see Laura does a good job of outrunning very fast defensive secondary for Tennessee State.
So third down and two. Just hear it here in the stadium, the fans a little bit anxious. Play clock is down to five, so they have to burn a timeout. So they burn the timeout, the first that they've had to use in the half. It's a 30-second timeout, and they've got two remaining in this game. ESPNU's coverage of college football continues Friday night. Akron takes on conference rival Bowling Green. College football primetime built by the Home Depot on ESPNU and ESPNU HD Friday at 5:30 Eastern. And for more information, as always, log on to ESPNU.com. Back to Jay, his favorite time of our telecast. Log on to Facebook today, search ESPNU and become a fan, and post your best tailgating photos and comments. We'll use them on Inside the Polls Monday at 6 on the U. Who should win the Walter Payton Award?
Got any thoughts, ideas on it? I want to hear from you.
Your guess,
your opportunity to go ahead. And
by the way, I'm going to go with you on that. I'll defer to you on this one.
You want to tell him what I think it's going to be right now?
Yeah.
Start the debate. Armani Edwards. I think he'll go down in history, be the first person ever to win consecutive Payton Awards.
Most people believe that he is the front runner this year.
I would think so, but there's been some tough competition, particularly as a young man in this conference, who I think may be a finalist for the Payton Award.
Christensen, big play, and on third down they convert and get the first down. Catch made by Lawrence Ricks.
Sense of urgency there. You got a team that's playing aggressive man-to-man defense. What's the best route against man-to-man defense? Any type of crossing route. Get something where he can run away from the defender. You'll see there at the end of that catch there, Ricks was bobbling that ball, lucky to hold on to it, but good play call. You can tell the offense anticipated man-to-man coverage, called a slant route, picked up the first down.
Christensen is now 10 of 20, 114 and one interception tonight. On the ground. Jimmy Potempa, ball carrier. He hasn't been used all that much tonight. He's out of, as I mentioned before, a transfer from the University of Michigan.
He can move it. You know, with this size, it'd be tough for a guy like him to possibly run in the rugged Big Ten conference there. Not a lot of scat backs in the Big Ten. That's more of a power football conference, so they're fortunate to have him here at Eastern Illinois, where he can have that big back and be the complement to him, part of that thunder and lightning package.
And they'll put a man in motion. Christensen on second down. Good protection. Catch made, no, incomplete. That is the second time that Laura has been smoked right as the ball was at his hands, and the second time he has dropped it. Jay, one of the things I want to ask you about, for our fans that are tuned in tonight, and you'll see this throw that was pretty much on the money.
Yeah, high throw here, left him exposed. Marquez Hall came up with a big hit.
But the kids that transfer, even though this is not Division I, so to speak, you know, at a high level like you're talking about, like a Big Ten, Big 12, those kind of things, these kids, maybe they transfer and you see what's happened on third down just because they want to play the position that they played in high school. They don't want to be moved. So they're still great athletes in this conference and all across the country like this.
Oh, I agree with you 100%. If you want to play football, and they're playing some good football here, with the scholarship restrictions now that are happening on the FBS level, there's a trickle-down effect. You know, they can't offer 100 scholarships anymore like they used to. So now you've got scholarship restrictions, and if you want to play, there's only so many spots.
Yeah.
And so you come here and you get an opportunity to play, and the folks that have dropped down, you can have success playing football. And
Well, the coaches are even getting excited on this sideline.
See it. High throw right here. Look at it. Go get it at its highest point. I like that. Did you see him catch the ball at the highest point? And he's telling the guy, see, that's how I coach you. Don't let the ball come to you. Go up and snatch it out of the air.
It's a fourth down and six. And the kick is away. Angled left side. And rolls. And marked out at the 13-yard line. That's a 33-yard kick with 55.9 seconds to go. Tennessee State, their last drive was 8 plays, 73 yards, and it took 3:24 for the score.
And they managed to get the skill position players involved in the mix. We're talking about Travis Ward, the running back. He was a workhorse, showing the moves, making defenders miss. They had a pass on a bootleg to offset it, but Ward did a good job of pounding the ball in there. Get the ball on the outside, and a big hit by the fullback coming out the backfield. Capped off by the quarterback sneak by McNarl. And the Tigers, late in the football game, have a four-point advantage.
Barring a turnover, they should roll into the fourth quarter leading in this game. 55.9 to go. On the ground, not much of a game. Their first possession of the second half, Tennessee State tried to run the football. And you might remember, Jay, they wound up losing about 8 yards on three different plays. Second drive, though, boy, a lot better. You see last drive, 73 yards. The first eight, 83 yards. But you know, much of that was done by Ward, who is the main ball carrier on that scoring drive.
And he's a true freshman, and they say he makes mental mistakes every other play, but at this point in the season, you're no longer a freshman. You play the college football year. You're a sophomore. He's starting to show his maturity.
Second down and 10.
Good call.
Rolling right. He'll keep it himself. And he's out at the 25-yard line with a first down. A little breathing room and a first down picked up with 9 seconds to go. Gain of 12 on that play.
Once you have a quarterback that has shown the mobility and the ability to separate from the defensive line, then you can get more creative in your play calling. You can go for the play action pass and tell your quarterback to outrun a defensive end. And that's one good thing that McNarl's done time and time again, is show the ability to scramble and avoid the rush.
Sure has.
And he just looked more comfortable outside the pocket.
So that is it. Tennessee State coming in not favored at all and having a rough year, having lost four straight, trying to pull off an upset and stop a championship celebration. Fourth quarter coming up. In what's at stake tonight, Tennessee State trying to hold on for their coach and maybe his job in jeopardy, looking to snap their four-game losing streak. On the other side for Eastern Illinois, if they win, they win the conference title and they're headed to postseason play. 7-3 our score. Fourth quarter is here. Jay Walker, Dan McLaughlin with you. There he is again. That young man has had a great game.
One-on-one, you know, that's just one where they can't block him, so they're trying to run away from him. But that tells you the type of athlete that Trevor Frerichs is. Look at this, number 99. Trying to slide, take on the block, spin him around, then go and get the quarterback in the backfield for another tackle for loss.
He's just shooting a gap and no one's getting on him.
Too quick. You know, it seems to be he's using his quickness. He's got the size to stand firm when he needs to. Great lateral movement.
Jay, he's got six tackles tonight. Loss of three on the play. There he is. He's got room to run if he wants to.
Touchdown.
Instead, he'll throw.
Wide open.
He's got him deep across the 40 to the 30. Still on his feet. 25-20, one man to beat. And brought down inside the five for Tennessee State. Joseph Hills, his first catch. And he's a transfer from the University of South Carolina out of Florida. that young man and a chance to make it two scores here.
They
had 72 yards.
They had the right coverage on. They had a blitz coming from the outside. We gave credit to C.J. James earlier for first forcing the quarterback back in. Well, this time McNarl puts an athletic move on him. Joseph Hills gets behind the secondary. Look at this. Changes direction. Almost gets to pay dirt. The skill position players for Tennessee State are starting to make some big plays.
Ward is in the backfield. Play action, looking for his tight end. He'll just dump it underneath. It's a touchdown. Lost his helmet, but he doesn't care. For the Tigers, the touchdown by Ronald Bright.
Look at that. They've got the cheerleaders up and going, and, you know, we sensed it. You know, you just could tell. I mean, EIU could not get on track. They didn't have that sense of urgency in their belly, and the Tigers recognized that in the second half, and they said, well, we'll take the fight to you all.
We didn't see this coming, did we?
Not at all. We knew there were some matchup issues there, but the fact that, you know, the offense woke up and they've got 14 points, they're at their average. I think the disappointing thing is, where's the offense?
And the biggest thing is
upset in the making here for Tennessee State. On the road, and they lead it 14-3 against a top 20 team. Touchdown pass by Tennessee State's quarterback, McNarl. Let's learn more about Eastern Illinois from Orion Buckingham as we take a look at our ESPNU Campus Connection school profile.
In 2007, there were two universities with the nickname Cradle of Coaches. One was Southern California, the other one, Eastern Illinois. And one of those head coaches has his Saints undefeated in the NFL.
Former Broncos head coach Mike Shanahan holds 2 degrees from EIU and was a coach on the 1978 National Championship team. EIU grad Brad Childress has coached the Vikings since 2006.
Well, you could have a situation where one of those coaches heads to the Super Bowl this year. Sean Payton, as he mentioned, Orion is undefeated, and of course, Brett Favre has helped out Minnesota.
Brad Childress.
Yep.
My old team, the Vikings. And I guess for EIU fans, the unfortunate thing, they're both in the NFC, so only one of them can go represent the NFC in the Super Bowl.
That's right. It seems. Mike Shanahan, he's not going to a Super Bowl, but he probably is headed to a huge payday.
Yeah, that's what they're saying. He's back in the loop for getting some coaching. And take a look at that. Shanahan, we know he's already got 2 Super Bowl rings. Childress and Payton trying to get there first. And arguably, with Childress and Payton, you're talking about the 2 best teams in the NFL.
No
some
doubt.
People think Vikings and the Saints. So they got a little coaching cradle here. Thanks so much for that one. I appreciate that, our campus connection. He's also doubling up as our red hat today, so he's showing like a special teams player. The more things you can do, the better chance you have of making the team.
That's right. So here we are, just over 13 and a half to go. Christensen, flushed from the pocket, has to run, tucks it, and gains 3 on the play.
Christensen keeps it. Gets out to the 42, gain of 4, brings up 2nd.
Mentioned that Tony Romo is statistically the top quarterback in history at the school, 2nd best behind Sean Payton. And Sean Payton, what a great career he had.
Look at those numbers. I mean, 10,000 passing yards and the completions. And, you know, look at the percentage. And college football changed from the time Romo was here and Payton was here. So having that type of completion percentage back when Payton played was phenomenal. I think he would have won a Payton Award had he been out when he was in college.
Depending on the spot, he may have the first down.
Jimmy Pacheco, the ball carrier.
And that was the 75-pound Potempa, Jimmy Potempa with that.
And right now, during this drive, we're going to see what Eastern Illinois is made of. You know, if you are who you say you are, as the song goes, a superstar, then have no fear. Well, right now is when you prove it. You know, 13 rank in the country, postseason on the line, down by 11 at home, plenty of time left. Put together your best drive, and let's see if you truly are a championship football team.
First and 10 with the ball in the 48. Christensen steps up and delivers a strike and another first down.
And the pass is the complete. The number 22
was made by Eric Laura. He's been his favorite target tonight.
Laura's doing a good job. The 5'10" freshman from Miami, Florida. He's not afraid to go across the middle. Doing the same thing with a play-action pass, going all the way across the zone, flooding the zone, lining up 3 receivers on the right side, having everybody run to the left, overloading the zone on the left side. They've had success doing that this evening.
Ball on the 39. They show blitz. Stays on the ground. And no gain on the play.
Very tough for Jimmy Potempo to find his rhythm in this football game. Just too small right now in this game. They seem to be manhandling him at the line of scrimmage. But one thing about Potempo, he's the leading receiver on this team coming into the game. 30 catches for 222 yards. We're yet to see him catch a pass.
Not one of the bigger players that you'll see in college football. They've tried to run with him, but it seems like on this drive at least, they've had better success with those little 8-10 yard dumps over the middle, and they've been able to get close to that first down marker.
Yeah, finding the soft spot, and because of the man-to-man coverage that Tennessee State plays, they're really hurting them with the crossing routes. Good play calling.
They will rush for Christensen. At least has a first down, and Moore slides to the 22.
When you play man-to-man coverage, and they're playing cover two, man-to-man coverage, you got two safeties deep, and everybody else is playing man coverage underneath. Well, nobody accounts for the quarterback in the passing game. So once you start to see those linebackers and defensive backs turn their back to you, then you become the running game. Great recognition by Jake Christensen of the cover two man coverage he was seeing and was able to run for the first down in the big game.
Gain of 17. Christensen at times has been frustrated with the plays not getting in quick enough here in the second half. You can see him motion over to the sideline and say, come on, let's go. Play clock as they come to center is down to 5 now. Put a man in motion. They've got to hurry. They get the playoff with 1 on the clock. And again, no gain on that play.
And part of the reason why you see Christensen, you know, trying to tell him hurry up as a quarterback, you like to have a rhythm in your offense. You like to, hey, defense gives you one look, come right back, give him another play call, and get some type of rhythm into the passing game.
See, transferred from Michigan, 2009, 5'7", 171.
Football is one of those games where you don't worry so much about the vertical. You worry about what you got inside on the inside. He's got plenty of arc.
Showing blitz on 2nd and 10. They'll pick that up. Looking end zone, has a man, and that's caught. Touchdown. Touchdown for Eastern Illinois. Charles Graves, a 22-yard touchdown reception.
I mean, that was a great throw there. You've got a left-handed quarterback rolling out to his right. Take a look here. He's rolling to his right. He's got to square his shoulders and keep this ball in bounds on the corner route there. Great separation by the wide receiver Graves to get away from him. And that's the tough thing. If you play so much man coverage, sooner or later they're going to beat you. Really hard and putting a lot of stress on your defensive backfield to ask him to cover that much in man-to-man one-on-one coverage.
See that graphic we just showed you. Signor is perfect on extra points, and he stays perfect right down the middle. 14-10. Little sense of relief here at home for Eastern Illinois as they pick up the touchdown. Good ball game, 10-11 to play.
Growing, developing, and exploring. That's what college is all about. At UT Martin, students are our number one priority. With more than 100 academic program areas, top faculty, and excellent facilities, we've earned a reputation for being a top public university in the South. We invite you to become a part of Tennessee's safest public university campus, to experience excellence in every way. We invite you to experience UT Martin.
What's that?
Aged Gouda. What do you call cheese that isn't yours?
Nacho cheese.
I understand someone needs a daiquiri recipe.
1.5 ounce light rum, 3/4 ounce of lime juice, 1/4 ounce sugar syrup.
Next time you have a question, ma'am, just text me at 542-542.
Text your question to 542-542.
Thanks, guys.
And get the new KGB apps for your mobile phone.
Cooper.
Tell me, Francois, how do we inspire ourselves to greatness?
Mandela wants us to win the World Cup.
From director Clint Eastwood.
This is the time to build our nation.
Comes the inspiring story of how one man's dream.
We've become more than just a rugby team.
United a nation.
This rugby is just a political calculation.
It is a human calculation.
Morgan Freeman, Matt Damon.
Listen to your country. This is it.
Invictus, rated PG-13, starts December 11th.
Stop replacing expensive ink cartridges and replace the printer you put them in instead. Switch to Kodak and swap for savings. For a limited time, bring your printer to Best Buy and get cash off a new Kodak printer.
What's an emergency that makes you feel so good? Health and energy boosting nutrients like 1,000 milligrams of vitamin C to give your immune system a fighting chance. Get a free sample at emergency.com and feel the good.
10-11 to go, 14-10, Tennessee State leading Eastern Illinois, number 13 in the land.
Julian Sample and Ryan Berry are deep for Tennessee State.
That was a great response there on that drive there. Backed up, everything started getting away from them. I'm sure that Coach Boo challenged his team. Right now, let's make a play, get back in this football game. His offense responded well.
College basketball is coming up. Well, we've got a good football game and just over 10 minutes to go here in our fourth quarter. Fielded at the 15. Good field position here. And the kicker had to make the tackle at the 45.
Ryan Berry brought
return of 30 on that play. ESPNU's coverage of men's college basketball at the Charleston Classic continues later tonight. LaSalle takes on South Carolina. The Charleston Classic on the U coming up right after us on ESPNU.
Seems like South Carolina have a little home court advantage there, right?
You would think so.
Charleston Classic, why don't they call that the Gamecock Classic?
Well, Tennessee State, last two possessions, 8 plays, 73 yards, a touchdown run, 5 plays, 87 yards, a touchdown pass.
Can they keep it going? And they were able to do it because their quarterback, McNarl, found ways to get outside of the pocket. So look for them to continue to try and attack the edge.
McNarl keeps it himself. Boy, he read that perfectly. Off to the races. 25-20 and steps out of bounds. He nearly handed that off at the last second, pulled it back. That's his read, Jay, and he comes up with a huge play and a gain of 35.
Yeah, but look, might have pulled his hamstring here, but you'll take a look here. This is a read. If the running back is tackled that quickly by the defensive tackle, then you pull the ball out of his belly, and he did a good job of running, and at the end of this run, it's coming right at you. I thought he went out of bounds a little bit too easy, but you see why. His hamstring might have given him some issues, and he decided to pull up. That could be big. If he tweaked his hamstring, because he's been the best offense they've had getting outside of the pocket. Whenever you keep him in the pocket, he's not an effective passer, so let's keep an eye on that.
On first and 10, he'll hand it off. And another hole brought down inside the 15.
Dante Thomas.
That's Thomas, who has not been used all that much here in the second half.
You go from a team that the offense was a liability to now the offense has some confidence in themselves, starting to believe in themselves, and the momentum is picking them up, and they realize they're in a football game and how quickly things can change in the game of football.
Last drive for Eastern Illinois took 3:27. This drive is fast right now. Narrow, 9 of 16, and quickly into that backfield was Gordy Kickles, the linebacker.
And that's what you're going to see right now. They realize they got a quarterback that won't be able to run from us. So if we bring the blitz from the outside or up the middle, they can't run from us. So let's crowd the line of scrimmage, do a couple run blitzes, and the missed tackle there by Kickles. But when you got a defense that's clicking on all cylinders, Trevor Frericks been there all day. There for another tackle for a loss.
8.5 to play, third down and 7.
Don't get too aggressive with your play calling here. Realize you're still in field goal range, so you don't have to hit the home run ball. If you get a field goal, you still have a 7-point lead.
And a timeout taken.
It's a good timeout there.
Tigers will take it. So they use their first timeout of the second half. Some key plays here in the second half.
Yeah, for Tennessee State, you know, it all started when they blocked that field goal, gave them some momentum, and then blown coverage. McNarl got outside the pocket, run after catch yards there, and the big hit for the touchdown, finding the fullback on the play action, and McNarl being the man in the second half. Kill him with his legs, with his arm, decision making, but that right there is a key thing right there. He's got that hamstring. How much of a factor is that? Because if he can't run, he's a completely different quarterback.
Well, that's the question here, because it's marked at the left hash. So they could go to the top of the screen, and that would be the big portion of the field they could go to get him outside. But if he can't run, and he's not been effective in the pocket, are you just content on running the football and getting the points with the field goal?
I think you've got to be. You know, you don't want to chance him rolling out the pocket if he can't run, because if he's tackled for a loss, then you really jeopardize your field goal range. And I think right now you've got to ask the young man, what's your favorite pass play, what you feel comfortable with?
Jay, they have not kicked a field goal since game number 5 in the Southeast Missouri State.
It could be 2-down territory.
Exactly. 3rd down and 7. They'll roll him out to his right. He's limping a little bit, but still on his feet.
Got around the edge.
And gets the first down.
What a gutsy effort. What a gutsy effort. You can tell clearly he's not as fast as he was just a couple minutes ago, but still had enough speed and heart to outrun the defensive end. See there, the misdirection. We've been calling number 99 all night. Couldn't make that tackle there. Good job getting on the edge and picking up the first down yardage.
So this will be 1st and goal with the ball on the 10. Clock running, just over 8 minutes to play. Tennessee State trying to pull off a huge upset and spoil that postseason bid, possibly for Eastern Illinois. Stack in the box, but this is Thomas. Gets back to the original line of scrimmage, and that young man has been active defensively tonight. 40 Kegels out of Lamont, Illinois, only a sophomore. He's 6'1", 215 pounds.
Yeah, look at him just push the offensive line there and get to the running back, and that's just a poor job there by that right guard. You see Kickles just push him, and he fell down. You can't get pushed. You didn't engage him. Go up and attack.
All the yardage on this drive have been on the ground. And remember the 35-yard kickoff return to set up good field position, too. Hands it off, Thomas up the middle, he's in for the score! Touchdown, 10-yard run with 6:57 to play.
The aggressive defensive call took the linebackers out of position. They blitzed up the B-gap, left the A-gap uncovered. Look at this, I mean, they're bringing the blitz. You see 46, he's coming in there in the backfield, ran right by it. Good job by Dante Thomas, and he took a shot to get to the end zone, but let you in a little secret. Folks don't mind getting hit in the end zone.
And he held on.
Yes, he did.
One of the players a little shook up down there after that collision near the goal line. Thomas, the 10-yard run. And this will make it 21-10.
That's Seymour Laughlin. That's a strong safety for Eastern Illinois. And he's the one that put the big hit on Thomas at the end. He saw that big low coming in Thomas. He decides to go low and probably got a knee to the head.
Six plays, 55 yards. It took 3 minutes and 7 seconds and a 10-yard touchdown run. Now the extra point to make it an 11-point lead. It is up and it is good with 6:57 to play. The underdog, undoubtedly Tennessee State, trying to pull off the upset here on ESPNU. Lowell, thanks, and we've got quite a ball game here and an upset in the making. 21-10, the Tigers leading the Panthers. The OVC, and the championship could have been awarded outright tonight if Eastern Illinois would win this game. Tennessee State just 3-6 this year. Return of 18 on that play, and let's go back to the last drive.
Well, hey, running the crossing patterns, playing man-to-man coverage, you have a lot of field to work with. If you get wide receivers running sideways, and they took advantage of it, and we saw Jake Christensen with the accuracy there, rose to the challenge of the occasion. Now the question is, Can he do it again?
Well, my big question is this. The Panthers of Eastern Illinois, what's happened to their defense here? Or has Tennessee State just been that good?
I think they just figured it out, and it all goes to their quarterback, McNarl. McNarl was getting it done with his leg.
Christensen, triple coverage, and it's knocked away, and a big hit defensively.
Woo!
I'm going to tell you, that's when you go back to your quarterback and you say, I mean, did I do something to you? Why'd you leave me hanging like this?
That's
running the
Eugene
seam route.
Clifford, by the way. He's a transfer from Ohio State.
Good effort there, but I mean,
what a hit.
Good hit there by Clifford. Tight end's got his back turned to you. You go over there and you dislodge him from the football. And one of the things we're seeing now is that's one of the adjustments. You know, they're not going with the man-to-man. They're going to play some more zone coverage. And you talk about Eugene Clifford, the transfers on this level, signed with Ohio State, played at Ohio State. So you talk about legitimate Division I talent playing here in the OVC now.
With time to the sideline, incomplete, brings up third down and 10.
Pass is incomplete.
You know, you're in a situation now with 6:39 to play. Can ill afford to turn the ball over? And I ask you this, Jay, if it goes to fourth down and 10, do you have to go for it with only two timeouts remaining? And at that point in time, maybe looking at just 6 minutes on the clock.
With 6 minutes, I'd say no. You're almost at that point. You know, because you've got the ball somewhere close to midfield, if you can, you know, if you don't get it, you can punt the ball, pin them back, and then maybe control the field position a little bit better. But it all really depends on how you set it up on third down.
Christensen nearly picked off. It is deflected. Who's got it? They will rule it's intercepted. And the Tigers have it with 6:31 to go.
Is that a fantastic effort by the linebacker there? I mean, that's how you guard a tight end. You know, when you're going to play man-to-man coverage, you stay close to him. Always know where he is. Look, he's got a feel for him. He knows where he is, comes around with the left hand, then goes and holds on with the interception there. That's a tough one there. Normally the tie goes to the offense, but look at him come over, get the left hand in there, paw it. They both have the ball there, but then it becomes of a matter of the pull. The aggressive pull once he landed on the ground, and they got away with one there. That clearly should have been a catch, and Eastern Illinois should have held the football. But instead, the aggressive nature by Tennessee State gives the Tigers the football.
Wow. Rico Council credited with the interception. Now they just put it on the ground and try to get some clock.
Now, this is a move that you kind of question. You know, I don't know at this point if you go with the lighter running back that's just a freshman compared to going with the big back that's got more experience when you talk about having Dante Thomas in there. You know, smaller guys, they can pull the ball from them. You know that this defense for Eastern Illinois is going to get very aggressive and go for the strip.
I want to go back to the last defensive play. You felt that that was not an interception. You felt that should have been a completion then setting up fourth and five.
Yes. Okay. I thought it should have. I mean, they both had possession of the ball when they landed and hit the ground. And tie goes to the offense, just like in baseball, right? You get there at the same time and just take a quick look at it here. This ball's tipped, and you'll see both of them have possession of it when they hit the ground. And then he wrestles the ball from him.
Wow. And a whistle before they get the play away.
The key is that they get a timeout call.
Timeout. Tennessee State. That's their second timeout of the half.
So 5:41 to go.
So 30-second timeout.
30-second timeout. Great ball game on this Thursday night. Upset possibly here in the making in ESPNU college football menu. And it's a good one, starting with Duke and Miami. You've got Vanderbilt, Tennessee, NC State, Virginia Tech. And then way out west, Nevada, with a big game for them. They have a 7-game winning streak on the line, and it's all on College Football Saturday here on ESPNU.
Yeah, that Miami-Duke game is going to be interesting. Duke still trying to get another win to get postseason eligible, and Miami's a little banged up. Ja'Cory Harris, they say, is practicing with the cast on there. So it'll be interesting to see how long he can go, and because of the transfers during the offseason, they really don't have a proven backup in Miami.
Well, this is why this game is so important. Again, if you're just joining us, Eastern Illinois, number 13 in the country, if they win this ball game, they win the OVC outright. So this is huge, and they need to stop. This will bring up a third down and about four, maybe even three on the play, and there's your bigger back. That's Thomas with the carry. Clock continues to run. Jay Walker, Dan McLaughlin, College Football Primetime, O'Brien Field, Charleston, Illinois. And it's home to the Panthers of Eastern Illinois. What's at stake? Tennessee State trying to snap a four-game losing streak. As I mentioned just moments ago, the OVC title on the line for Eastern Illinois. And for Tennessee State, so much more than just trying to snap a losing streak, maybe trying to save the job of their head coach. Rumblings out of Nashville, his time could be through. Showing blitz here. Keep it on the ground. He keeps his feet, lunges forward. Very close to the first down, depending on where the spot is.
You talk about a great effort. I mean, this is just all heart right here. They bobbled the handoff in the exchange in the backfield, didn't have a good grasp, but then spinning, twisting, turning. Legs keep moving, lunging, almost picking up the first down. It's going to come down to a measurement, but what a gutsy effort.
We see where his left knee was when he was down. And depending how generous of the spot that they get, now I think it's pretty generous, to be quite honest with you. They get this first down, it's 4:45, and then you're talking potential of four more downs at least.
And on this level of football, the spot is final. You can't challenge on this level of football here until you get to the playoffs. In postseason, you can use instant replay. But during the regular season, there are no instant replay challenges there. And spot was generous.
So they get the first down with 4:45 to go. The Panthers, by the way, with two timeouts remaining. Thomas, who lunged to get the first down, 16 carries, 63 yards.
You see right now the quarterback looking at the play clock, trying to eat a little clock, not trying to snap the ball until less than 5 seconds appear.
Thomas.
He fumbled.
Fumbled it. And who's got it?
Ball is loose on the play.
I think it was the offensive lineman that got beat off the, that was the reason for the fumble, because he got beat. He might have been the one to recover the fumble.
And that will stay, it looks like, with the Tigers.
That's Anthony Woods, big number 63. He's the offensive lineman there.
Clock continues to roll, just over 4 minutes. Second down and 13 upcoming.
Let's take a look there. You see big number 63 gets pushed in the backfield. He's the reason why the running back got dislodged from the football. And once again, that was Trevor Frericks with the pressure there. But at least Woods held on or grabbed the football for the recovery.
Coming up next, college basketball. LaSalle in South Carolina. This is the young back, Ward. And at some point, you got to think about burning a timeout here if you're the Panthers. 3.5 to play. At this point, it's two possession.
Clearly, they've got to get that one. You see that Tennessee State is just taking their time. They feel comfortable. And think about the position they're in right now. As you take a look at the running back comparison, and both backs managed to get it done. Thomas had the more spectacular runs, but I really think it was that hard running by Tabrett Ward that really ignited this offense, when he basically carried the ball all the way down the field by himself, carry after carry, that really got them going.
So over 100 yards combined with those two. Under 3 minutes to play. Third and 13. Ward tripped up.
So now's the time where I call a timeout.
Exactly, and they do. With 2:49 to play. So they have one remaining here in the ball game, and trailing by 11 points.
30-second timeout.
And Jay, I'm sure you'd like to explain for folks that are tuning in, this level of college football, there are automatic bids to the FCS playoffs.
Yes, and you got the eight conferences that are going to get automatic bids. Whoever the champions are, those bids are in. So Appalachian State is already in. They've clinched. Holy Cross is in. They've clinched. South Carolina State is in. Southern Illinois, Montana. Those teams are all in. They're guaranteed. Other teams you see here, they're in contention for, like we talk about, the Colonial, the CAA, as they're known by, Richmond, Villanova, William & Mary. One of those teams will win the conference outright. It gets the automatic bid that goes with it. But I also think that that conference will see five teams get in. So all those teams you see there on the screen will get there. The OVC, not so clear. You know, only one team is going to get in from the OVC. And I think it's going to be either Eastern Illinois or Eastern Kentucky. And whoever wins the automatic bid will probably be the only team that will get in.
So 2:49 to play. Kick is away, and
oh, shanked it.
Bad. As he tried to angle it to the sideline, and he shanked it near the 35-yard line. Lowell Galindo, let's send it back to our ESPNU studio.
Dan, thank you so much. We're about a minute away from tip between LaSalle and South Carolina. We'll have this game coming up after the completion of our football event. You'll have a chance to see Rodney Green, fifth in scoring in the A-10 last year. Now back to Dan and the professor.
Oh, the professor. 8-yard kick, by the way.
Wow. Yeah, that's a tough one, too. That stuff, you can't leave that open to chance. Every yard is going to become so valuable in a two-minute offense, and they gave away at least 20, 30 yards of work.
2:43 to go. Over the middle.
Dropped.
And again, another drop.
What a throw.
He's right in the numbers, literally, of Lawrence Ricks. Hit him right in the chest, it looked like.
I mean, you want to talk about some arm strength. I mean, the ball's on the far left hash. Christensen dropped back and threw that ball all the way across the field. That was a 15-yard curl route. Put it right on the money with some velocity. So much velocity that the wide receiver couldn't hold on to the ball. He's got a little gun. Small, compact frame, but he can zing it.
Christensen, by the way, Jay, 12 of 28, 149.
He's the son of a quarterback, too. His father played quarterback here back in the day.
Completes. No flag on the play. See Ricks, he popped right back up looking for a flag. He doesn't get it. Third down and 10, 2:33 to play.
Yeah, that's that weak side linebacker, John Jones, a transfer from Florida. Just look at the reaction. Once the ball leaves his hand, he's there right away. I don't know if you can time it any better than that. And did a good job of coming around the wide receiver, the intended target.
Again, we remind you, LaSalle and South Carolina basketball coming up at the conclusion of our ball game here. Eastern Illinois, chance at a conference championship, but down by 11. Christensen fires to the sideline. And they're going to say no. No catch on the play. They're going to call that incomplete. The intended receiver was Eric Laura. So fourth down here, and the championship possibly on the line right here.
Yeah, this is what you want. You want to help out your quarterback here. And this ball here is a little bit low, but you got to come up with that catch there.
And he may have.
So close, but
looking at that replay,
there's that rule. Anytime that ball is going to touch the ground, they kind of tend to take it away from the offense. So you've got the season on the line right here for Eastern Illinois.
3 for 9, this spot. Christensen, watch out. He's hit and incomplete. That may do it with 2:22. Tennessee State takes over on downs. They'll have it. First and 10 with the ball on the 30. And the Panthers have just one timeout to stop the clock.
And that's about two timeouts too few that you need.
And barring a miracle, it looks like Tennessee State is going to pull off a huge upset on the road here.
The Colonels, you think they're excited?
Oh.
At Eastern Kentucky, and look at the look at the coach. He got so excited. Hey, coach, easy.
Yeah, why not? When you've lost four straight, it's been a tough year. Flag on the play. Ward the carry. It stops the clock with 2:17 because of the flag.
Well, they've got to be careful here. Although you've got the ball and this game is yours to lose, you haven't won it yet. You can still lose it. Don't get the penalties. Protect the football. Hold on to it.
Holding. Offense. Number 72. The penalty is declined. Correction. The penalty is accepted. No, okay. The penalty is declined.
PM Next College Basketball 2009 Charleston Classic. LaSalle and South Carolina. That's coming up. Dan McLaughlin, Jay Walker with you.
Brings up second and 10.
Second and 10 with 2:17 to play. Clock continues to roll. Play clock is under 15. Game clock is now at 2 minutes to go.
Fumbled
the snap. Ball is loose. still no indication. And it looks like it will stay with the Tigers. It does. That's a couple of fumbles now in the last two drives here for Tennessee State.
You know, you take a look at the final standing. So now what happens is Eastern Kentucky beat Eastern Illinois early this season. So the head-to-head, they get the automatic bid because of the head-to-head. People look, and they've got to win. They got to take on Jacksonville State. Now people say, what about Jacksonville State? Well, Jacksonville State, they can't win. They can't participate in the postseason this season because of the APR rule requirements. So they're ineligible for postseason play, even though they're ranked one of the top 15 teams in the country. So Eastern Kentucky's got in their own hand.
Just over a minute to go. This is Thomas, and you're talking about the APR, and I know folks at home are saying, well, what exactly is that?
Yeah, that's what they've got, what they call it, the adequate progress report, or something like that, of that nature. I'm not sure exactly what the acronym is, but it means that your student athletes must graduate at a certain rate. And if they don't do it, if you're coming in there with these abysmal graduation rates, then NCAA is coming in there saying, hey, we're not going to allow you to go to postseason. So they're penalizing the schools.
Academic progress report.
That's what it is. The academic progress report. I mean, and that's a good rule there. I mean, it tells you you can't just go there, use kids, let them play football, then not give them an education. It forces the schools to give these student athletes an education, which is what it's all about. I love football. We all love football, but you're a student first and you're an athlete second. And Jacksonville State, unfortunately, this year, was dinged with the APR.
Well, then they can make this weekend their
postseason, their playoff.
You know, they can play spoiler. So 21-10 here, 101 to go, and the Panthers have just burned their final timeout. For those of you that have tuned in for basketball, we'll get you right out to it. LaSalle and South Carolina here on ESPNU.
One little final note on the APR. You'll see that more on this level than you will the FBS level because of the transfers. You know, people transfer down, and the kid comes to your school and he transfers, and you know he had academic problems at the school he was at before he got to you, and he continues to be a poor student. So I believe that it'll inadversely affect FCS schools more than it will FBS.
Dante Thomas, the ball carrier.
Thomas on
fourth and six. Panthers will take over on down.
Short of the first down. And so it's up to the defense of Tennessee State to hold one more time. And boy, have they done a great job tonight.
I mean, to come in here and limit this offense to 10 points time and time again. They just had the Panthers settling for field goal attempts and opportunities. And just a great gutsy performance by this defensive unit from Tennessee State. They play like this all year long. I mean, they came in averaging, only giving up 14 points a game, and held this team to less than 14 points.
Christensen has to run. Remember, they're out of timeouts. He's got to get out of bounds. And does. Steps out at the 35.
Run out of bounds at about the 38.7
seconds to go.
First down.
The thing about it was, you know, this game was there for EIU to take. They had opportunities to move the football. Defense was holding up, wasn't allowing Tennessee State Tigers to get first downs at all, but they just couldn't capitalize and gain any momentum. And in this case here, you can clearly say it was the offense that let them down because the defense played spectacular for about the first three quarters.
Still on his feet. Has to throw and picked off. Just trying to throw it away and it's picked off. And this may go for a score. Tackled though at the 25. Johnson, a 17-yard return with the interception, and this will do it. They can take a knee, and now Eastern Illinois has to hope for a little luck over the weekend.
And Christensen did a good job of getting outside the pocket, escaping, but I believe Johnson just put the exclamation point on the upset.
McNarrow, by the way, what a story he's been in this game with that sore hamstring. 9 of 16 for 135 and a touchdown and 114 passing yards in the second half.
That's unfair. They grabbed him, held on to him, and at the end of the day stood there and took it.
This will snap their four-game losing streak. And for an embattled coach, how proud he must be of his kids over there on that far sideline.
Think about it, Tennessee State. You're there. Got some teams with some more fight. They didn't give up. There's room for improvement. There's no question. But you know, I like to judge teams by the heart they showed and playing that brutal non-conference schedule they play when they play the who's who of black college football, then having to come into a very competitive OVC. Not an easy job. Not an easy job. Got to think about it. My mom always said, be careful what you wish for. You just may get it.
So a solid win and an upset. 21-10 Tennessee State over Eastern Illinois. For Jay Walker and our entire ESPNU crew, I'm Dan McLaughlin. Coming up next, we'll take you to basketball. South Carolina, LaSalle. And as always, for more information, log on to ESPNU.com.